Hey, let's start the show.
It's November 1st, 2012. Welcome to This Is Only a Test, the official podcast of tested.com. I'm Will Smith. Joining me today, as always, Norman Chan. How are you doing, sir?
I am trying to set up an account on this Microsoft Surface.
You look like you're touch typing right now with your touch keyboard.
Dramatically touch typing. I'm doing all right.
Directly to your left, Gary Whitta, wearing a fabulous Abel Brewing Company shirt.
Yeah, I got this from you, didn't I?
There was maybe one in 21 chance that we would all be wearing the exact same t-shirt today.
Oh, I have way more than 7 t-shirts.
I'm saying multiplied by how many t-shirts Gary wears.
So I have weekday 7 t-shirts. And you have what, 50 plus?
T-shirts?
Yeah, t-shirts.
You I mean, should it's, not never have 50. It's never happened. In, like, I don't think happened with two people.
I think maybe I've owned 50 t-shirts my entire life, but only 4 or 5 t-shirts I want to wear to work. If you have 70 t-shirts, that's too many.
I agree. You should see the bottom of my closet.
Gary, those should go to charity.
How are you doing, sir?
I'm well, thank you.
You recovered from the big show this weekend?
Yeah, just about. I always forget how much it really takes it out of you. Like, you joke about how tired you get, but you don't really.
No.
It's no joke.
And you think that if you, like, after Saturday, you left a little early. Of course, you have a baby ticket.
Well, I left before you, but I think I probably ended up staying up later than any
I would say you had a worse, because, like, I made it to the end of the baseball game on Saturday night and then was unconscious on the floor.
That. I think, but did I make it to the end of the ball game? I can't remember.
The ball game ended around 8:30.
It was all like a hoist. Yeah. Yeah, I think I did.
Which is game three of the World Series.
Yeah.
But even if you make up for sleep,
it was game 3 of the World Series.
If you sleep and you compensate, because after staying up for, 24 to 30 hours, if you get 12 to 16 hours of sleep, that doesn't actually help anything.
Well,
your body still needs more.
Well, yeah, I mean, I think you need a couple of solid cycles to fully recover, but I did feel mostly okay the next day after a good solid, 10 or 12 hours of sleep.
And then night, you're just tired earlier.
I slept like 12 hours on Sunday, Saturday night, and then woke up on Sunday morning. It was maybe, like, you feel a little off. You're a little slower than normal, maybe. Maybe making decisions is harder than it would be otherwise. And then we went to a party on Sunday night, which was probably a mistake, but not something to be missed.
Yeah, I'm surprised that you had the energy for that. I was still, I was like alive again, but I certainly wasn't ready to rejoin the living.
So mm-hmm. Not only did we go to a party, we went to a party in the Mission as the World Series was finishing.
Wow.
After game 4.
That's hardcore.
So
did you see anyone like overturning buses or anything?
I think we were 2 blocks away from that. 2 or 3blocks away from the craziness.
Yeah, so the time when Gina and I were like, no, we need to leave now, was when I was looking at Twitter and our friend Quinn was tweeting, yeah, the mob line is at 19th and moving its way toward where we were. And I was like, no, I'm done. We'll see. Thanks for the party.
Yeah, it was sad. I mean, everyone was great, very glad to see the Giants win the World Series in 4 games. It was terrific. But like then, idiots have to go out and ruin it for everyone by just acting like morons. It's
burning
sad.
Buses.
Yeah.
So let's update on some October cast off. Your Flopsy Space Rocket, your first child is fine.
Yeah, I got a text from Leah at some point. I don't remember even when now because it's all kind of a blur. But at some point,
maybe like 3, I think.
Yeah,
it's 6. Maybe you missed the last 2.5 hours.
I'm getting tired just thinking about it. But she had a cold that she caught from me, and also, as it turned out, an ear infection, and she just wasn't doing great. And so I didn't feel comfortable sticking around here any longer. Get her into the hospital and get her looked at, and she's much better now. But yeah, it was a rough few days.
And that's the first sickness, really, right?
She's had a couple of little things. When we took her to PAX, she was a little bit. She caught a little something there, but she was basically, this is the worst thing that we've had in terms of really kind of fretting over her health.
Ear infections at that age can be a little gnarly.
And
they don't know what's going on, and it hurts. And
and we think she may also have started teething as well. So that's
is that the right time for a baby to start teething?
Yeah, it's kind of on the early end of it, but it's certainly not always outside of the bounds of possibility.
Always an overachiever. But everything, she's feeling better now.
Yeah, I'd say she's 99% recovered. But of course, now what happened was I first had the cold and I gave it to the baby And I think now the baby has given it to Leah, because now as the baby's getting a bit, Leah's now kind of hitting bottom in the cult. It's gone all through the bloodline.
So is this from licking the baby? No, I know we talked about that.
I think it was from me sneezing too much around the baby when I had the cold or something. Yeah.
You're going to have to mask up in the future.
Yeah.
Okay, so Norm, your recovery Saturday night, what did you do after Oktoberfest was over?
I also went to a similar Halloween party.
Oh, you went to another party on Saturday night?
Oh, no, Saturday night. I went to sleep immediately.
Okay. Yeah.
I tried listening to the radio for the baseball game and fell asleep in like the fifth inning.
So I made it to the top of the ninth and then fell asleep. And Gina woke me up for to replay the last three outs of game three. And I ended up watching those laying on a floor with the dog cuddled up beside me. And then Gina woke me up like 2 hours later and moved me into the bedroom. So that was, I don't remember any of that.
Yeah, I got home and we immediately took the baby to the hospital, which meant I had to drive, fortunately I was kind of awake. You kind of go through cycles. I was in a waking cycle.
Yeah, I mean, just like stepping outside, you kind of get a little burst of energy for the first.
Don't get me wrong. Yeah. I mean, there was a point there where we were kind of sitting in one of the rooms in the hospital, waiting for the doctor to come back with the medicine for the baby, and it was all I could do to keep my eyes open. I was so tired. And then we got home, went straight to bed, and I just sat in bed eating some kind of chocolate cake that I bought for myself as a consolation.
like hotel cafeteria cake?
No, it was from like a bakery. It was a cool thing.
Did you get it from Shanky Bakery?
No, I didn't.
Oh, so good.
And watching the baseball. And I think I got to the end of the ball game. And right after that is when I turned it off and crashed out and just slept like a sleepy thing.
So did the doctor, when you took the baby in, did the doctor, he or she, look at you and were like, What the hell happened to you, man?
No, because what happens is you go into like baby protection mode and you just seem fine. I mean, you know, if you seem frazzled or fried, they just assume because you're freaking out about the baby. Yeah. She wasn't like, how long has it been since you slept or anything like that? Although, you know, I'm glad you didn't ask me that because you probably wouldn't let me leave.
That would have been hard to explain.
Yeah.
We do this podcast and then you have to explain what a podcast is. And then and it was for a charity for kids in hospital a lot of layers of explaining. So yeah. Sunday kind of rest day, went to the party. Monday and Tuesday were off. I think today is the first day I felt back to normal.
Do you have any fever dreams? It was like Ambien almost.
No,
like 12 hours sleep.
I just sank into the deepest, darkest hole and didn't emerge. I don't think I dreamt. I think when you sleep that much, I don't think you even dream.
I had crazy dreams. Near the end of this cycle. I think I'm awake, but I'm actually still asleep. Oh my God, I gotta check the score of this baseball game. What, the Giants lost? No, actually, that was a dream. Thank goodness that was a dream. Wait, let me get back up. Okay, can I check the phone now? Nope, still a dream.
So mine was weird. I dreamed that I woke up early, that I like woke up at 6 because I couldn't sleep because I'd gone to bed too early. And then I went in and I played XCOM in the living room before Gina was up. Oh, and I started an Iron Man game. And the only way I was sure that this hadn't actually happened was there was no Iron Man game on the PC.
Oh, wait, so you dreamed that?
I dreamed the whole thing.
Wow.
So then I got up at 8:30.
So you
dream
about
Man.
Playing video games. Yeah. Norm dreams about watching baseball. You guys need to kind of get more ambitious with your dreams. You know you can do anything, right? You can fly. You can be fucking Superman.
You
can do much better.
I might have flown into the living room.
When you're a child, you have more awesome action dreams. I think as an adult, there's a logical part of your brain. It's like, this can't happen. And even as you're about to do something amazing like fly, your brain goes, oh, this is a dream. And then you start falling. You're still in the dream. But like the rules of physics start applying again.
I've never been like Superman or anything, but I do. You're right. As an adult, I usually just have like freaky nightmares or just weird, weird, weird dreams.
Yeah.
You don't get to really have like the fantasy type dreams, like where you get to, you know, be a superhero.
Like Homer in Chocolate Land.
But I do occasionally, still have my recurring dream about playing for England in the World Cup final and scoring the winning goal.
Wow.
Yeah.
Just occasionally.
For years, I had a dream that Lou Ferrigno as the Incredible Hulk was going to chase me down. Like that was my night terror.
Wow.
Was the Incredible Hulk was going to come get me.
And not just the Incredible Hulk, the Lou Ferrigno version.
Well, the Lou Ferrigno version was really fucking scary. He
was it actually,
eyes.
Were you imagining like it was actually the Incredible Hulk Yeah. For, as played by Lou Ferrigno, like, yeah. but the real Hulk, or just Lou Ferrigno dressed up as the Incredible Hulk.
The Incredible Hulk was very...
Because both would be pretty scary,
The Incredible Hulk was very scary to me as a child, because he was a character that was completely out of control and let his emotions rule, and that was not
something that
all,
you saw every time you looked in the mirror.
No, not the exact opposite. Like, I was always a really dialed in kid.
I thought Dwayne Johnson's Halloween costume this year was very
good. What was his awesome.
He was the Hulk.
He was the Lou Ferrigno.
And he's one of the few people who can actually pull it off. Yeah, from a physique point of view.
That seems like it too easy of a costume. Like,
yeah, he just needed some purple pants.
It reminded me a lot of when he played the Rock Obama on Saturday Night Live.
If he did that for Halloween, that would be awesome. That was actually a really, really good skit.
That was good.
So after Oktoberfest, Hurricane Sandy basically flattened the East Coast. From DC and North Carolina all the way up to New York. It seems
kind of came out of nowhere.
Well, no, not really. They'd been talking about it for a week.
Were you glued to the coverage?
Couldn't stop watching.
Yeah.
I mean, A, because we have friends there. B, because we were just there a couple weeks ago. And C, watching the way, like, the entire infrastructure breaks down, and then the way the community kind of comes back together around it is always fascinating.
So describe what Sandy was. And
so Sandy was the perfect storm. Basically, I mean, it's a hurricane, warm, wet air coming up from the south, a nor'easter, which is wet, cool air coming in from the north, and then hit an Arctic weather front from the inside that made basically really bad shit happen. So it wasn't really, like, as hurricanes go, it wasn't a particularly destructive hurricane. Like, the North Carolina and Florida people were looking like, oh yeah, category one, you guys are chumps. But the thing that made it really devastating was it was massive, 500 miles wide, and dumped an unbelievable amount of water in a relatively short period of time.
And in a place where they're not prepared
ill-equipped.
Yes.
For that. I mean,
In the Gulf states, they're at least used to this by now. New Jersey, maybe not so much.
Yeah, I mean, in coastal Florida, people build their houses up 15 feet on cinder blocks so that when this happens, everything's cool.
Yeah.
Or at least it's the least damage possible.
Yeah.
In New York, where you're talking about an island that the bedrock underneath Manhattan is hollow at this point. You know, they've bored out so many layers of tunnels all the way down that there's an incredible amount of flooding going on there, to the point that the train tunnels and I think two of the three car tunnels are still completely filled with water.
Yeah, and it's interesting that we it was different this time in that, you know, we're used to seeing these kind of rural, these beach communities in places like Louisiana and Florida get wiped out, and it's terrible, obviously. But seeing a major city like New York get smashed, I mean, it is, you know, a lot of people were making kind of the Roland Emmerich jokes, but it really was almost kind of like that.
I mean, it makes you feel, you think you're safe and you think you're prepared for something like that. And no one's really prepared for something.
New York's
like that.
A really big city, and
it's very dense,
and not all of it was obviously,
that's
affected.
True.
I mean, the photos we saw, I mean, subway system, obviously flooded subway is crazy. The shots of the elevators closing, the water pouring in, that carousel shot, but those all mostly the lower side, right?
Lower Manhattan, Brooklyn, Long Island.
No, Brooklyn's fine.
But some parts of Brooklyn are
like
were
New
pretty
Jersey,
underwater.
Only parts of New Jersey really affected.
I was just reading a story this morning in the New York Times that was fascinating about how, so the demarcation line, where power went out in Manhattan, is like right at 40th Street.
Yeah.
Right? Huh. And so, and you've seen those pictures where one half of the city is fully illuminated and the other half is just black. And it's really interesting that right at that kind of, now this is kind of
so
like...
So Times Square has power? Had power?
Not all the way through, but a lot of stuff.
Half of Times Square.
But there's a very specific line that I believe is at 40th.
Well, there was that's where it ended up.
Right.
Yeah.
So in that area now, they're talking about how it's like a tale of two cities. It's a really interesting area, like right in that kind of electric DMZ where people, they call themselves the dark people that come from... That come from the blacked out part
of
New York.
The no electricity areas, yeah.
To charge their, like, people are just putting out power strips and letting people charge their phones. And like, there's a Chase Bank which has opened its doors and just let people hang out and plug in power strips and free coffee. And you know, you see the good parts of people and the bad parts come out during these events.
And that's one of the things that's happening. I mean, that's happening in Brooklyn, Queens, and all over the city as well. You know, if one block has power, people are just dropping an extension cord with a power strip attached to it out over their front rail.
Now,
tons of pictures.
How would you have done in this situation? Because you've said before how, like, at an airport, you are very grabby and not sherry at all about outlets. So I imagine that
in this situation,
I think you'd probably be sending the dark people back to their dark
normal different
revolution.
What are the different rules?
I would make artisanal coffee for them and let them charge their devices. I mean,
artisanal coffee, really?
Yeah, of course.
I don't think they're fucking. Oh no!
Give them a taste.
A long line of 5,000 people.
Yeah, I don't like the way
coffee. You're
pouring that over.
I know you're really cold, but wait another 15 minutes until the Chemex is ready.
Yeah, exactly. You gotta let it cool back down.
I can only make 4 cups of coffee per
I'm just
half
saying,
hour.
I would dangle
artisanal coffee.
Some guy comes to you has another cup of coffee in like 3 days. He just wants a fucking cup of coffee. You're gonna make him wait 20 minutes while you do the perfect pour
it
over.
It doesn't take 20 minutes. It takes like
high standards, man.
It takes 5-6 minutes.
High standards.
It's worth the wait.
There are people crowded outside like buildings where like, Starbucks and stuff where they were closed, but the Wi-Fi was still working.
Yeah.
And so you see people just hovering, hundreds of people, dozens hovering around storefronts.
Well, so
grasping for the Wi-Fi.
Now my question is, how do they get all that water out? When you're dealing with like millions and millions and millions of gallons of water, I know that they can pump out a certain amount, but like, do they just have to wait for it to recede naturally?
Well, no, it's a tunnel, so it's closed. It's
no,
not
I'm,
gonna
but,
recede
I'm, but I'm
naturally.
Thinking about more like, you know, the Atlantic City and Hoboken, which is like underwater, basically.
So a lot of the problem happened because the storm hit it almost exactly at high tide, like leading into high tide. So there was more water in the area to begin with, and then that meant the storm surge was much worse. Yeah, a lot of it happens. A lot of it will recede naturally above ground. Now, emptying the tunnels is a whole different issue.
That they do have to pump.
Yeah,
right?
There's FEMA and the Army Corps of Engineers are bringing in massive, massive pumps. There was an article on Wired's Danger Room blog about it this morning. Because of the way the pumps work, you know, you can't suck water more than 30 feet. Because when you suck something up a straw, air pressure is what's pushing the water down and making it go up the straw. Even if you put a full vacuum at the end of a straw, a 35-foot straw, the water will only come to 33 feet, right? Because that's how much air pressure is pushing down in the water at the bottom of the straw.
Yes.
If you want to push it up, you have to submerge the pump deep down in the tube and then let it go. So the upshot is they have to move the pumps every 50 or 60 feet. They can only run 30 feet of hose, put the pump down, start it up, suck the water out. And they also have to pump slowly because the water might have affected the structural integrity of the tunnel, and they don't want the tunnel to collapse as it's going down. So, like, it could be a very long time before the tunnels go between Brooklyn and Queens and Manhattan, and then on the other side, from Manhattan to Jersey.
Yeah, I mean, logistically and engineeringly, if that's even a word, it's fascinating and, you know, kind of overwhelming at the same time.
Well, the thing that's always interesting about disasters like this are how fragile like all of our civilization is. Like on what a tenuous ground we are. Power goes out. There's elderly people stuck in their high-rise apartment buildings all through Manhattan that have now been in there for 3 and 4 days with no new food, no new water. New Jersey, 80% of gas stations on coastal New Jersey have no gas now. It's worse in New York and on Long Island. Long Island is probably not going to have power back for 3 or 4 weeks in many places and longer in some. I mean, it is truly an apocalyptic
society
disaster.
Endures.
Society endures. But so many of the things, like the cellular network, there were a couple of reports about the cellular network that showed that even a relatively small drop in the number of cell sites that are open, coupled with increased use because people are calling their family to let them know they're still alive, is capable of crippling the entire cell network to the point that it just doesn't work.
Well, maybe you're not in on 40th Street, if you're in like 60th Street or something, or 80th Street, and you still have power, maybe some services are out, what do you do to weather
to help
the storm? Or to help? Like, what do you
invite your friends from the flooded areas up. I mean, everybody's, I know tons of people who are couch surfing, who live in like the East Village and stuff like that, and are staying with their friends further north, or in Brooklyn or wherever. So,
do you have your 72 hour bag?
Yeah, I made it about 6 months ago.
72 hours, is that enough?
No, I don't think so. Our 72-hour bag.
Two 70-hour bags? And even with 72, once you go into, like 72 hours, how many days is that? Three days. 3 days, you still use stuff sparingly from
you
that.
Ration.
Yeah, yeah, you ration very carefully. You always want to.
And there's like, I believe there's an official government website you can go to, right?
It's 72hours.org.
Yeah, and it will tell you all the things that you should really have in a bag in your house for this kind of eventuality.
I think we're going to do a video next week because I've made mine. I added a bunch of stuff to it that I think is exceptionally useful.
The thing that terrifies me about living in California, I mean, we all have different kinds of disasters, right? Out here, we're more earthquake land.
Yeah.
And as terrible as floods and hurricanes are, we at least can see them coming days away. And there's, right. you know, like, as you can see, a lot of the damage and a lot of the problems, terrible though they were minimized by the fact that they were able to pre-position assets and get people out and board up windows and do all the things they could to mitigate it. With an earthquake, you've got, what, 5 seconds to prepare?
That, yeah.
And so this is, so you can, you've got to be ready all the
time.
But it's, you're going to get that. You don't have that luxury.
So, well, I mean, there's sometimes it's bad to have stuff come in advance too, because you have the boy who cried wolf effect, where there's 3 storms in a row that miss or aren't as bad. And then you follow up with this one where it hits at high tide and you end up with a storm surge that's 5 feet above what they expected.
Right. And this is why you wind up having people like Chris Christie having to say things like, if you don't follow this evacuation order, don't expect us to come get you, because this is on you. Yeah. Because a lot of people just think they can ride it out. And obviously they end up just making things worse, not just for themselves, but for the emergency services that have to go in and get them.
Well, and that's not so bad in North Carolina and Florida and places like that that are less dense. But when you're talking about someplace where there's, what, 8 million people that live in New York City, 14 million people live in New York City overall. I can't remember what it is.
It's millions of people. It's the fourth biggest city in the world.
Yeah. Then the calculus becomes very difficult for the early responders.
I've asked myself this question before. Maybe one of our listeners would have an interesting answer to it. I was trying to figure out, at least in the United States, what is the area or areas where you are least likely to get hit by some form of natural disaster? So, like in the Gulf Coast, you've got all the hurricanes and floods. In California, obviously, you're looking at earthquakes. All across the Midwest, you're looking at tornadoes and that sort of thing.
And Arizona, blizzards.
And entire Northeast, you're looking at massive snowfall and blizzards and things like that. But there obviously are areas.
Southwest.
Like the Pacific Northwest is pretty cool, right?
I think
the Southwest, you don't like to get much.
Pacific Northwest gets Southwest ice storms and Northwest. I mean, remember, Seattle's like 40 miles from Mount Rainier, which is the only volcano in North America.
Yeah, but wait, that's never happened. And therefore, will never happen.
Says Gary Witta, yeah. Pompeii resident.
Southwest. Arizona,
yeah, I guess it's that. Well, yeah, I know, but you're dealing with 100 degrees every day. You're just miserable every day.
And also,
anyway.
What else is there to do around there?
And literally, like a drought makes Phoenix untenable. I think you're. I mean, I don't know. That there's any place that's truly safe. You know, where I grew up in Northeast Tennessee in the mountains is pretty good. There's no geological activity.
But
too mountainous for most tornadoes. They're really unusual.
What about the hill people?
Well, I mean, you do got to watch out for the Melungeons. Do you know what the Melungeons are?
No, what is that?
This sounds really,
I don't think
sounds
I want
like
to know.
Sounds like something a elitist group of people would call just a bunch of normal people. Melungeons.
No, the Melungeons.
Is this something that they tell you at night to get you to go to sleep? Little horror stories for children?
Don't let the Melungeons. They go for limbs.
If you don't go to sleep, the Melungeons will come for you in the night.
They like children fingers, the kitty fingers.
What are the Melungeons?
So the Melungeons are the mountain people. They were the.
Really? Are they like the Hills Have Eyes type people?
I mean, that's what we always said in high school.
A diet of squirrels and infants?
No, so the Melungeons are, according to Wikipedia...
Oh, you're looking it up?
A term traditionally applied to one of a number of triracial isolate groups of the southeastern United States, mainly
what
in Cumberland Gap.
I
assume it's Native Americans and Caucasians and Sub-Saharan Africans is what Wikipedia says.
Wow. All right.
So are they like the hill tribes in Game of Thrones? Remember those guys?
Kind of like that, yeah.
Right.
Like the guys, they're not affiliated with any king. They're living free, right. And they were living up in weird valleys.
Some would
like
argue they have the best life.
Deep valleys in the Appalachians.
Yeah.
And like there's a lot of valleys and a lot of mountains, and there could be people that moved in there in the 1800s that like lost contact, stopped coming out to the real world. And just were self-sufficient for
it's
the last 100 years.
It's fascinating to think that, isn't it? In a country as modern and as industrialized as the United States, that there are still parts of it that are not really recognizable as the modern world.
Well,
right?
They're not exactly like they're not. They wouldn't. I wouldn't say that they're like
I mean,
aboriginal.
I mean, they're not like.
It's not like dudes in loincloths.
It's
not
like National Geographic or anything.
No, but it's
loincloths.
What? You know, but yeah, so
I mean, they've got trucks and things, but
I don't think they do. I mean, they maybe do now, but I don't think they did for a long time. For a long time, they were.
But, I mean, look at the Amish. That's fascinating as well.
Well, that's a religious thing, though, not necessarily we lived in a valley.
But they've eschewed all the trappings of the modern world.
Yeah, they are aware of it.
They don't want
not
machines.
All of them, just the ones that don't. So they do a lot of water power stuff, hydraulics. No electricity. Electricity is the devil, according to most Amish.
Right. I got into an argument with someone a few years ago about whether or not there were Amish websites. Because one of us was of the opinion of like, well, how can there be? And yeah, as I believe it turned out, there are.
Well, I bet they pay. Gentiles or whatever the equivalent is.
I think some disciplines of Amish people are more severe about that stuff.
The internet addicted ones, right?
Well,
no electric blenders, but we want our IMs and we want our Twitters.
Well, right. In the way that Amish,
like you could have five things that run on electricity, and you must choose them well. What would it be?
To be honest,
in these days of multifunction, like you could just say,
iPad.
I'll have my Microsoft Surface, and I'm good.
Then you need
and the other four I will donate to other people.
I've wasted my choices. Sandy, a couple of other things. We're going to talk about the survival bag on the site. I think this is a topic.
You should survival. Do. Do you have you should do, because this is actually
is it
like
buried, a, or is it just in your garage?
Like it's just my garage.
It's nice to look at cameras and iPads, but you should actually do a video that makes do a fun video about packing an emergency bag, and people would watch that and do it, and you might save some lives.
Well, there's also a right and wrong way of packaging, layering the bag,
right? Yeah. Well, and to be honest, a lot of our stuff is just on shelves in the garage because I figured that would be most likely in an earthquake situation. We may not be able to go in the house, but we'll probably end up camping
in the
backyard.
What if you need to throw it in the back of a car?
Well, then
you should keep one in the house and in the car, right?
Well, I feel like there should be like a go bag with sneakers and raincoats and stuff like that.
Well, I think that you should come up with your own unique
take
on the emergency bag, and you should do a video on it. It'd be interesting.
And one of the things I was talking about this morning with some people on the internet is what's the highest density food and water and stuff you can get into like a 72-hour bag. Is it better to do a water bottle and iodine pills and a filtration thing? Because water, of course, is one of the heaviest things you can carry.
Mm-hmm. I don't think you should have water, a lot of water pre-prepared. You do the filter and iodine pills.
Well,
you're
supposed to keep 3 gallons a day per person.
Right.
According to the 72-hour thing.
If you are near an emergency, if an emergency is impending, you can fill up water more easily at home. More easily, plumbing doesn't automatically shut off without warning as much as electricity and other supplies and stores do.
See, for me, I would set the standard that whatever the nature of the disaster is, for whatever reason, you cannot leave your home and all the plumbing is out. So whatever water is what you have, you're not bringing any more in. I would go by that standard.
Well, because the thing is, in a flood, New York wasn't affected by the flood, actually, because the water supply, because their water is piped in from a very long way away. But typically, in a flood, you can't drink water.
That's not true. There are plenty of people in New York City that don't have plumbing right now.
Well, right. But I'm just saying, like, the water system, the municipal water system as a whole is still safe to use if you're in one of the unaffected areas or lightly affected areas.
Right.
And like, in Katrina, that wasn't the case. All of their wastewater treatment and water treatment stuff was flooded and unable to be used.
Leah found something the other day that would be a good addition. It's a USB hand crank charger. So anything that takes a USB cable, you can crank it up and charge it.
Well, not anything.
Which is a lot of things these days.
Yes, a lot of things. But a lot of those times, for those things, you have to worry about the wattage and what the specs are for the charger.
You can't just
expect they'll charge, you know, anything.
One of the great things I saw, you know, one of the pro tips I always had was that you fill the bathtub when there's a tornado coming.
Yeah,
or hurricane
trash bins.
Well,
like get a clean trash liner in a trash can and fill that up.
So the thing that I saw, though, so you don't typically use that water for drinking because the uncovered water kind of spoils over a period of time.
Right.
But the thing I saw is a bathtub liner. So it's a big bladder you put inside the bathtub and then you fill that with water
and then scoop stuff out and can filter that or use it for.
You can put a couple of drops of bleach in it and it'll keep the whole thing
for a long time.
You certainly
want drinking water. I mean, we've got like big jugs of
gallon
jugs of drinking water at home for that. But, you know, the toilet and the bathtub is just for, you know, washing and flushing the toilet and things like that. It's handy.
I don't think it's reasonable to expect that if services and in a real emergency, you're not going to be in your home for, you know, more than a week before you have to, you know, leave the area.
Or shit's back to normal.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So you're not going to be drinking out of the tub water for a week or a month unless things go real, real, real bad.
If it's a hurricane and it takes, don't live where there's winter storms. When you live someplace that there's winter storms, you can if there's an ice storm, then the people in Quebec 10 years ago when the ice storm hit, or I want to say Northeast Tennessee, power was out for weeks, 4 weeks in some places, and then you live off of a wood stove or a camp stove. So
I think that would be an interesting video to do, be educational and informative.
Well, we'll definitely do
and
that.
And entertaining.
And I'm going to post a link to the danger room thing. I didn't get to do it before we started recording.
So that's Sandy.
Also, dying weather satellites. You know, the National Oceanic and Atmosphere Association has been asking for new weather satellites for like 5-6 years now, and we haven't been funding it. So this seems like a good time to kind of pony up as a nation.
It's a pretty,
say, hey, let's rebuild the weather satellites.
It's a pretty good example of why knowing things about science is helpful.
You don't say.
It's not just pie in the sky. It actually saves people's lives to know science.
That's exactly right. On lighter note, Microsoft on Monday had a Windows Phone 8 event. Yeah. They talked about Windows Phone 8 kind of lightly.
Really?
Yeah. So they'd done
for a Microsoft Windows Phone 8 event. That's surprising.
So what were they announcing here?
Well, so they talked about hardware. Nokia and some of the hardware partners at different events talked about the actual hardware for the Windows Phone 8 phones. Because like before, it is a standard platform. You know, it seems like they're leaning into Snapdragon on this release. I think all the phones are 1280 by 720. Is that right, Norm?
Yes. The 1280 by 768.
Yeah, sorry. The cameras seem to be the main differentiator is how big the screen is, what kind of camera they're putting in, and then the physical dimensions and weight of the phone.
It seemed like I saw just some of the coverage from after the event, but it sounded like what this event was about was really rolling out a lot of handsets from different manufacturers, whereas before we had just been really kind of seeing the Lumia stuff.
Well, so there were two parts to this. One was that Joe Belfiore came on stage and talked about Windows Phone 8 features that they hadn't really talked about. I mean, they talked about them in blog posts, but they were kind of buried for normal people. And this was to introduce three or four features in a kind of friendly, live blog-friendly setting at Bill Graham down in San Francisco. So they talked about groups, which is a thing in Windows Phone 8 where you can say, okay, my family group is my wife and my kids and my mom and my sister. And it gives you a way to get the kind of shared interactions that have been part of Windows Phone for a while with people who may or may not be using Windows Phone.
Talk about the experience for most likely people who, you know, not a lot of people, families are going in and say, we want 5 Windows phones. Maybe someone wants an Android, dad needs a BlackBerry, or you know, kids want an iPhone or something.
Yeah.
If there's 2 Windows phones in that family and a lot of different other phones, how does that work?
So the way it works, we just tested it today because I hadn't really got anybody to actually respond to one of the texts before because they thought they were spam. But the way it works is you say, okay, I'm going to make a group. It comes with one group by default, your family group. You say, I want to invite somebody to that group. You pick their contact out of your contact list, which is synced from Google or Facebook or wherever. Send a text message, I assume, to their mobile address. It says, I'm going to send a text message. I'm going to run grab that, actually.
I guess that back half of that explanation will have to wait.
Well, we'll see if we even get to it. How are you doing, Gary?
I'm all right. I'm enjoying watching you use your Surface.
Yeah, so it's kind of a weird tangent. For people just listening, we had our doorbell ring. Will wants to get the doorbell, but I'm setting up my account on the Microsoft Surface. Will has been using and testing it for since I guess last Friday.
What's he going on about? There you go. Stuff. Some mail
stuff. Oh, my new business cards are here.
Wonderful.
So
podcast gold.
Oh, this is all awesome.
Okay.
All right, so Windows Phone 8 family.
What the fuck?
I didn't do that.
What? Did someone steal my mail?
Uh-oh, oh, that's your harsh. Precious stickers.
What? No. This is something I paid for.
Oh, no.
Oh, well, I got the shipping receipt. This is a micro SIM converter, nano to micro SIM stamp thing.
Is it? It's sure just it's an empty package. There?
It's been stolen.
I would complain.
Yeah.
Oh, that is
bullshit.
You sure it didn't fall out?
No, I'm not sure. I didn't realize the mail was unsealed.
Holy crap.
Okay, so while we continue the podcast gold here, it sends a text message, which I haven't seen. What does the text message say? I sent one to you, Norm.
It says, you've been invited to a group. I can actually read the text message right now. And it gives me a link to a website where I can subscribe to the group. Yeah, it says, hi, I set up a room. They call it a room on my phone. Join it. Then we can privately share calendar, photos, group chat, and notes. And it sent me to a website where I could log in with my Microsoft account, which I had because I have an Xbox or an Outlook.
Everybody has a Microsoft account, I think, at this point.
And then they give me instructions actually to add my Microsoft account on my phone as an email account, in which point, I guess, the stuff that you share to that calendar will get popped up in my calendar. But really, only indicate.
Hold on. How does it know which calendars? It only pops up in your Microsoft calendar.
Microsoft calendar.
So you would have to sync that with your phone, which you probably aren't doing right now,
and
if I had to guess.
That's why it gave me very loose instructions on how to do that.
Hmm.
It did not seem very useful for someone
really,
with
not
an
really
iPhone.
Feeling the game changiness of this just yet.
No.
So, I mean, there's some communication stuff that you can do with that as well. I'm going to fire that up right now and see if I can send you a message.
Was this really the big thing they talked about at
Dude, they didn't
yeah,
talk
I can't
about
believe
shit
te- I can't believe sending texts to family members was their big...
Well, so the talk at the event was mainly about like family-friendly stuff. One of the other big things they talked about was Kids Corner, which is this. So you swipe the phone to the right, and it opens up a kid-friendly, like, thin version of the OS that just has the stuff that you make accessible to the kids.
Oh, okay.
The
parental controls for your phone, basically.
It's not really parental controls, because all they have to do to get back into your phone is swipe up, and they can get right back in like it was a normal phone. So it's more, it's literally just so that they have a place that they can customize when they want to play games on your phone. And he brought his kids out to talk about that. It was very cute.
Kids
and all
Corner.
That. Yeah.
It's a family phone.
They talked about live tiles from third party. We're already kind of starting to see that. Like the new weather app is much more active. It actually has the weather on it, and it tells you where I am and what stuff looks like. I mean, you can see it right there.
I mean, yeah,
it looks like the weather.
It's everything they talked about when they first announced Windows Phone 8, not the backend stuff.
That they didn't deliver on, pretty much.
Well, not Windows Phone 7. When they had that Windows Phone 8 event
right.
A couple months ago, and they talked about how, you know, they have the new start screen, the new home screen for Windows Phone now.
Yeah.
With the three different sizes, and, you know, each tile can be a big tile, small tile, or tiny tile, micro tile. And they talked about the new app development process. All that is now live and is
yeah. But they didn't talk about. I mean, they didn't talk about like developer cut or anything like this in this meeting. It wasn't that kind of a thing. They trotted out Jessica Alba, who talked about how much she was paid to love the phone and stuff like that.
How much was she paid to love the phone?
She didn't say
a
that
lot.
She didn't say that she was paid to love the phone. Gina said that she's surprisingly cheap right now because her career has kind of been on hold for a couple of years. So she figured she was 50 or 100 grand.
That's a lot.
Well,
that's not
bad for an afternoon's work, is it?
Well, she's also going to be in ads as well, I'm sure, which will be more money attached.
I'm sure she like had to memorize a lot of stuff, though. There's a lot of rehearsals.
So she wasn't on the teleprompter, but Belfiore was asking her a bunch of questions.
Oh, so she had to... I mean, she got the binder. Yeah. She read any of the pre-interview.
They talked about copying her music from her iPhone using the Mac connector to get her iPhone music onto the
phone. You think
part
of it's like the Switch campaign is going the other way now.
Do you think she was
off the iPhone and onto their system?
Do you think that she part of that contract means that she has to use Windows Phone in public for all the proper
photos? I don't know.
Photos?
Some of the
I would put that in the contract.
People were already tweeting pictures of her using an iPhone that were dated like earlier this month.
Yeah, that's
so.
The problem.
See? Well, maybe she switched on the day of the event.
Maybe, yeah.
You know, one more related to this. Some company recently just hired Megan Fox to do the exact same thing. Tech company.
Which company? So, do we know?
I think it was like Asus or something like that.
Mm-hmm. Acer. Yeah. Acer has Megan Fox. So that's how low her career is.
Would you, if Microsoft...
Well, Acer is the biggest laptop manufacturer in the world.
Setting aside any journalistic conflict norm, if Microsoft came to you and said, we want to pay you to basically use all our stuff.
Yeah. If Norm was just famous.
But you had to switch completely into the Microsoft ecosystem.
You know, since we're talking about hypotheticals here, in terms of things that I could not do,
yeah.
If Microsoft came to me and said, switch to all our stuff, use the Surface, use a Windows 8, Phone 8, right, and we'll pay you, you know, if I was famous enough where they could pay me $100,000 to do that,
yeah,
right, I would do that and buy Apple stock right now at $600. Since we're talking about hypotheticals.
No, but in the contract would be you can't do anything like that because that would be a PR blowback for them.
How would they know? How would anyone know? It's just like, what's his name? Jack Black saying, you know, he took that money for Kung Fu Panda and bought all that Pixar stock with it.
God, that's
basically
terrible.
What he said.
So the handset you've got there, Will, is that's the one that they gave away on the
So
day,
this
right?
is the 8X.
This is the HTC Windows Phone.
The Windows Phone 8X.
Which is interesting because HTC is a handset maker that people like.
Well, they were an early Windows Phone partner. They had launched phones last year and they had some kind of dopey ones.
But I think it's almost like they've had their Etch-a-Sketch moment, haven't they? Where they've said like, forget all of that. This is the real Windows Phone now. We're doing it. This is the real.
This
like,
is
That
it.
Was all kind of a false start. Now we're getting serious. So anything that kind of came before is kind of like, we were just kind of mucking around. This is the real shit now.
Well, so there were some rumors posted, or not rumors, but insider information. You know, you take that with a grain of salt, that said that all of the stuff about the Windows Phone 7 APIs being abandoned, so those apps won't work on this phone, was happened when all that got pulled under Sanofsky's division at Microsoft. So
after Jay Allard,
after Jay Allard, after the Courier and all that stuff, there was a kind of a power struggle for a while, apparently, and then it's been pulled back in. So theoretically, going forward, these apps should work. I have to say, the ecosystem on this phone is fantastic. It's much better than it was with Windows Phone 7. Belfiore was talking about apps for a fair amount of the conversation.
They're going to do all the checkboxes.
Yeah.
And out of the 50 most popular iOS apps.
No, apps. It was iOS and Android apps. So they were the
most popular apps, period, across
I assume that means 50, because there's a fair amount of overlap, I would think, with things like Kindle and Pandora.
They had a majority of them.
Yeah, so they did one big reveal where they're like, and we have something that we know you've all been waiting for, and everybody was thinking Instagram, and then they pulled back the curtain.
Really?
Pandora.
That's the one everyone's waiting for. Instagram.
Well, I mean, everybody assumed it was Instagram because of the Facebook Microsoft relationship, and Instagram's now a Facebook company.
See, I think it's very difficult for them to make a big deal out of offering things that everyone just takes for granted on their other phones. It's like remember when Apple brought in cut and paste. And Android users were going, well, come on, we've had that for ages. You can't make a big deal
about that.
But
they weren't selling that to Android users. They're selling that to Apple fans who are,
already converted.
Now, oh, awesome. This is cut and paste done right. I mean, they're speaking to the existing
user base. But it's like boasting that your phone has Pandora is like boasting that your phone can make phone calls at this point. I mean, it's just a basic piece of functionality you expect a smartphone to have.
So the issue I have is like the free apps are pretty good on this situation now. If you look at it, it's like Facebook and YouTube, and there's a bank app, and then there's a bunch of ringtones garbage, and then there's YP Mobile, which I think is an AT&T app. I don't know why that would be in here.
What is that, like a Yellow Pages?
It's like Yellow Pages. Yeah, it's junk. It's one of the things I delete. The Google app, Google Maps. There's a lot of official Twitter, PayPal, my AT&T, Flixster, Netflix. Like you get down here and there's actual real apps. The top paid is a little bit different story. It's kind of like the Android market used to be, where it's all a bunch of really weird, highly specific stuff like Human Japanese, which is a Japanese language learning app that costs $10. A graphing calculator. And it's... I don't know. Like, well, the Bacon It, which is the Reddit viewer, that makes sense. It's just feels a little hinky still. And one of the things that carries over from the Surface with this phone is launching apps takes a really long time. I'm not sure whether that's because the loading screen kind of doesn't give you anything to look at, but that spinning little ball thing, or if it's just
launching apps from start, from cold,
yeah.
Anything takes a long time. And that's part of the, I mean, it's even a lot of stuff gets hidden behind the scenes. It is a, It's still Windows.
Well, Windows is fast in my experience. This is...
Well, on ARM. It's Windows on ARM.
Right. I mean, I think that's the problem. The nice thing is if you're loading something that's been loaded recently, it's in the cache, and that seems to make it load faster. But yeah, it's definitely improved. I'm still a little raw over about how they treated the Windows Phone 7 people, frankly. I think it would be hard, although they have given some incentives to upgrade and stuff like that.
I got to say, I played with that particular handset a little bit earlier. That was my first time using Windows Phone 8, and I don't know whether or not it's going to be successful. Microsoft's obviously going to make a real go at it, but I like it. I feel like at this point, if I had to switch ecosystems, I would probably go there. Even with the relative paucity of apps,
yeah.
I like the experience. I like, sue me, I like the brightly colored tiles. Mm-hmm. I like the simplicity of it. It's the, for people that complain about skeuomorphism on the Apple side, this is the absolute other end of that scale.
And that is absolutely true. One of the things that they have started doing with this that's really interesting to me is they're filtering interesting data out of social networks like Facebook and Twitter and stuff like that. So there's this app called Local Scout, which... on first glance is really super obvious, right? It shows you the stuff that's around you. And right now it's showing me the Mars Bar and Susie's Cafe, which is down the street. And it's like restaurants. It's places you want to go have coffee or get lunch or whatever.
Based
on my current geolocation.
Right.
If you go right one, there's events. And these are events that I assume are on like Facebook events that are geolocated to areas around here.
Oh, okay.
So it's like store, like there's a Herman Miller event at the fancy office furniture place down the street.
And this is all interconnected and, like, at the OS level.
And it's all at the OS level. I don't think that this is, so this is through Zvents, which is, I guess, a like an event aggregator. If you go one more to the right, then you end up, go a couple more to the right, then you end up with this tab that's called For You, and it's all stuff that people have liked or checked into, your friends have liked or checked into on Facebook, which I think is super interesting. It's something I don't know how to find anywhere else.
See, it depends. I said before the podcast that Microsoft is great at solving problems that nobody really has.
And well, that is true.
And I wonder if, you know, in looking for items of distinction,
solutions,
like, things that they can point to say we do this and Android and iPhone doesn't. Like, here are the things that make our experience unique and benefits, yeah, and things that you can't get anywhere else. At this point, it's actually tough to find that stuff because so much basic functionality is covered pretty well by those other phones. You can do your own version of those basic functions. You can also try to come up with really innovative different things. But mapping and finding local stuff, it's all so basic.
Well, I wouldn't say mapping, but...
Well, maybe not on the Apple side, but you know what I mean. It's like you can find stuff that's nearby. I wonder sometimes how much of this stuff is useful to real people and how much of it is useful just to the hip, trendy, young actors and actresses that Microsoft puts in its commercials that live lifestyles that are utterly unlike any real people in the world.
I agree because, for example, for the scenario where I want to find local stuff,
yeah,
and I, you know, I think it's cool that you can...
You're never going to open an app called Local Scout.
No, not even that. I mean, if
it's a terrible name.
I think the way they're using the likes... likes aren't useful enough where that becomes useful to me.
I mean, Ken was...
Check-ins are interesting, though.
Likes are...
If I
see
so
indiscriminate.
If I see that our friend Christian, who has good taste in restaurants and bars, has checked into someplace 35 times, I'm probably going to think, oh, that's probably a pretty cool place because Christian's much cooler than I am and she knows where the cool places are.
But it's like something Yelp already does already, and that's a bigger...
Except for nobody checks into Yelp.
I'm saying reviews. The reviews on Yelp are more useful to me than one like a friend's like on Facebook.
Well, that's a personal thousand. Thing.
And Yelp is now baked into all kinds of things. It's baked into Siri searches for restaurants. It's in all, you know, it's in all your basic maps applications.
The thing that was interesting to me about this event, as I was sitting in the audience there, is that they weren't talking about the initial 20 minutes was talking about apps and things that people actually use, and they didn't start getting into the specifics of features until I think maybe 20 minutes into a 40-60 minute talk. The last 20 minutes we're talking about the SKUs that were going to be available when Ballmer came out and recited a bunch of speeds and feeds and everybody kind of zoned out.
But that sounds like they had it right? You go with the consumer facing stuff first.
I mean, I think
things that people understand.
I don't think that what I'm saying is I don't think that they're doing what you're... In an alternate universe, they would have spent 20 minutes talking about Location Scout and how revolutionary it was.
Right.
It's something I discovered on my own because I was like, what's this tile on my home screen for? And I clicked into it and was like, oh, that's kind of interesting. I don't know that I'll ever use it, but it's neat. And I think that what's happening with phones is that Neat doesn't sell phones. I think what you have to do is sell a holistic vision of usefulness to sell phones. And I don't know exactly how you do that if you're not actually making something holistically useful.
If I see one, Microsoft in particular are terrible at this. Like if I have to see one more ad for say Windows Phone or particularly remember those Kinect fucking ads that are cool. All like these parties in like New York apartments of like hip young urbanites.
You mean where Kinect would never ever work?
Yeah, they're all playing Kinect, and they're all like these hipsters. Nowhere outside of an ad agency do those people exist.
You were right, Norm. You're right. We were in New York for a whole week, and we didn't get invited to one single Kinect party.
You didn't get invited to any hip young urbanite Kinect party.
I'm so surprised that all those people that we know in the New York media establishment
they don't really exist.
Interesting. So yeah, that was the Microsoft thing. Jessica Alba came out.
So availability for phones and stuff and Windows 8. I mean, if someone want to hold off on Windows Phone 7, maybe was intrigued by the the Lumia stuff, the 820 and 920, 810, 920.
Yeah.
And was waiting for Windows Phone 8. Can they go out and
I think it's November, now? Right? Mid-November. I don't remember the specific.
So what's the hardware to get? Like on the Android side, if you do a bit of reading, you basically know that you get either the One X, the S3, or the Nexus 4,
yeah,
which is not out yet. But you would get one of those three.
Well, we'll talk about that in a minute. I don't know that I would recommend the
Nexus
4.
Is that right? Do you think that's right on the Android side? What one Android phone would you recommend right now for someone? I know I want Android. What phone do I get?
Well, let's talk about that in a minute.
Okay.
The nice thing about the Windows Phone, and this is also kind of the bad thing about the Windows Phone, is that the hardware is fixed. So everybody's running the same CPU. Everybody's running more or less the same memory and storage configuration,
which is great. So no fragmentation.
Well, it makes it really easy to make decisions because you go and pick the one that has the color you want in the camera. Like, look at the camera, look at the size, like the physical size of the device.
Right.
And base your decision on that
stuff. So the differentiators between the phones are all things that you can see and touch. And you have to worry about, where is this phone actually the most powerful one?
I'm sure somebody's going to eat us alive for saying this because I'm sure that I'm
forgetting something obvious. Wait, so the cameras and everything, the specs are all the same?
The cameras are a little bit different.
I think specs, like, you can't say 8 megapixel, same 8 megapixel. You have to, it ties to the software, ties to the processor. Because for shutter speed, for processing, how much...
But they're all running the same processor.
There's so much...
So wait, outside of industrial design, how does Samsung say, well, this is how we're going to be competitive with HTC if they're locked into the same
space? So they'll make bigger, smaller devices.
Beats.
HTC has Beats by Dre.
Oh, my God.
It has a B logo on the back.
Yeah.
My hunch...
Beats for bullshit.
My hunch is that with a sugar cube, you can probably scrape that right off.
Let's hope so.
All Beats seems to do is make the sounds louder. I don't know... It makes things
louder. And your wallet thinner.
Well, no, this doesn't cost any more than any other Windows phone. I think for consumers, it simplifies stuff in a way that's okay. The place that it gets kind of hinky is that in 6 months when they release, or a year when people start releasing refreshes of these designs, they'll still be using more or less the same guts, maybe slightly faster clock speeds, but... Like, they won't be able to take advantage of new CPU enhancements until the next time they rev Windows Phone 8, which could be 2 years.
But I do like that. It's because that's the thing about Android is that anytime you've got a lot of choice, there's also potentially a lot of confusion, right? It can be very baffling to navigate, like, the Android handset market with so many phones out there. With Windows Phone 8, if they are more locked down and standardized, then you do have the luxury of saying, well, I just like the way this one looks or feels in my hand or whatever.
And it's kind of, it is analogous to the iPhone model, you know, the Apple model, where they release one handset a year. You know, if you're releasing one platform a year and then the things that change are the industrial design and maybe screen size and camera, then and amount of memory and stuff like that, then that makes the decision, you know, I think that part of me wants to say that takes the best of both worlds from a SKU perspective, but part of me also says that it stifles innovation, especially since they seem to be on a similar refresh cycle to iOS.
So now, it stifles innovation because the reality of software development now is that it takes about a year, and you can't say, hey, we're just going to... I mean, they'll do the incremental updates just like iOS is.
I think it stifles hardware innovation, not software innovation.
I think hardware needs that time to develop. R&D needs more time on the core stuff, which takes longer than on the surface. Let's throw a bigger screen on there. Let's put a bigger, different color chassis on there.
Well, so updates. I mean, the thing that changes, yeah, maybe. I think that you can make an argument either way. The thing that worries me is when you get toward the end of the cycle on these Windows 8 phones and they're getting ready to release a new version of the OS and by nature a new revision of the hardware platform, this platform is going to have real boom and bust cycles where it sells like gangbusters in the first part of the 2 year cycle. There's a spec bump midway through, which was what the Mango Tango, one of those refreshes was last time. I can't remember. 7.5.
Mango.
And then sales take a dive after that.
Now,
and I think that's going to be hard for the manufacturers to cope with.
The other question, what about OS updates? If the hardware is standardized, does that mean that Microsoft will, that no matter what handset you've got, everyone will get their OS updates at the same time?
In the past, it meant that they got OS updates much faster than Android. There were some initial problems where it seemed like they were kind of figuring stuff out. It'll be interesting to see whether they can deliver simultaneous updates across platform this time, or if it'll be something that, you know, some people get the updates early and some handsets don't.
I got to tell you, I like it. I like the experience. I like the colors. I when they first announced Surface and Windows 8 and all that stuff, I was very cynical saying, look, Windows is not the thing that anyone chooses to use. It's the thing you use because it's what you have at work and it's just there. And it's not like you have a ton of choice.
I don't think that's true.
But that's my opinion. And having said that, I do think that now that I've used the technology and played slidity around with the tiles and all the color, bright colors, that Microsoft has done a very, very good job, at least on the surface, of repackaging and rebranding and representing this new iteration of Windows as something which is actually fun and can be in your lifestyle in a way that Windows was never really thought of before, I think. Whether or not the hardware and the actual implementation of it is going to back that up, I don't know. But Windows seems kind of cool now in a way that it never really was before.
So when we talked about Surface RT on Oktoberfest, I was pretty hard on it. I think I stand by that. I don't think it's very good. Mainly, yeah, the we'll talk about that in what we've been testing. The app situation between Surface RT and Windows Phone 8 is dramatically different. And the talk that they had and the time that they spent getting people onto the Windows Phone platform, you know, those top 46 apps of 50, is you can't underestimate how important that is. Because the difference in ecosystem, I could give a fuck about Angry Birds, right? Angry Birds is not important to me. But things like Pandora and Dropbox and Google Drive and a good decent Twitter client. It's not a great Twitter client, but it's a passable Twitter
Shazam
client.
And Shazam and Netflix.
Right. And all the Facebook app.
The building blocks of the app ecosystem.
Well, but if you look at the stuff that you use the most, the things in the top first page of your phone, then they actually have most of that stuff now. The Kindle app on Windows Phone 8 is quite good.
And that's why I'm saying, like, I don't need 750,000 apps. I only really, it's nice to have the choice, but in reality, I only really need about 15 or 20 apps that I use regularly.
But once you've got the major 20 are not the same as someone else's 15 or 20.
That's the problem.
Right.
If you do statistics and 90%, all their, you know, if you take 90% of the Windows users, their 15 or 20 adds up to an essential maybe 100 apps.
I would think 200. Yeah. I think probably the top 200 apps consist of the mass majority of the curve.
Yes.
Of use.
Where you begin to fall behind is in areas like games and in kind of quirky, more interesting apps that are always going to be on iOS and to a lesser extent Android first.
As of now. Yes.
Yeah. So things like the game of the moment, whether that game is Draw Something or
Letterpress
or whatever.
Right.
The place that I think that they need to improve on Windows Phone now, just from spending, like I said, 4 or 5 days with it at this point, 4 days with it, is that they really desperately need to work on performance. Like things like app load time from a cold start and stuff like that are... I need to do some side-by-side testing. I don't necessarily think it's slower than iOS, but it definitely feels slower than iOS and Android.
You're talking about in terms of just app
in terms of like tapping the screen, from the time you tap the screen until you can do the thing that you want to do.
Yeah, it seems like they
Sorry, go ahead.
No, it seems like they, from using both the 8X and also the Surface, the UI stuff is extremely fluid. It always has been.
Yeah.
Because they realized they didn't want to do what Android did with Cupcake and Froyo and have a lot of jankiness in the UI smoothness.
Keyboard and UI priorities has always been
very important, because that's with input, super important. But once you get into the actual, you know, real multitasking and launching programs initially, and even within the programs, loading documents, that stuff is still very slow.
But like when you had your Surface on earlier, and Will, you had the Windows Phone 8 kind of up next, and I could see both screens at once, and I'm like, it all looks like part of a theme, and it's a family, and if I can use this, I can use that. And again, I don't know if in practice it's really going to work out that way, but that kind of holistic approach and all these devices kind of seem like they speak the same language, and once you learn one, you can learn you basically know all the other devices in that family. Theoretically, it could be really great.
That's true. The place that the Surface RT breaks down, the reason I wouldn't recommend it right now, is that the apps that are here and make this quite good, the things like the base Twitter app and the base Facebook app, just aren't present. I mean, MetroTwit on Windows RT is a flaming piece of shit, right? It just doesn't work. You can't refresh columns. It's hard to reply. It's just bad. And Tweetro won't even fucking launch on mine. I mean, those are the two that people recommend, and they are both garbage.
Is there not an official Twitter
app? No. There's an official Twitter app for this,
Twitter
for the phone.
They are making a kick-ass Twitter app.
That's awesome. I'm saying, wait until you have those apps. There's no Facebook app for the RT.
That's not cool.
So you're left using the shitty M.dot versions of all these things that you're used to having a good, clean app experience for.
See, that's where they dropped the ball.
And
you cannot launch this stuff and not have basically Twitter and Facebook. Official, clean, good, basic versions of those. You've really dropped the ball if you did not launch with those in your pocket.
This is the Surface RT is a product that they should have launched six months from now. Once the base Twitter apps.
Think they could afford that?
Yes.
I think they just would have
launched the x86 version first.
They should have started earlier. Well, they're doing the complete opposite. They should have launched the SDK earlier and work
they
harder
launched
on
the SDK has been out for a year. If they needed to go to fucking Twitter and Facebook with a dump truck load full of money and said, hey, either you guys develop this or we will pay you to let us develop
Microsoft
it.
Microsoft sure owns did. A big chunk of Facebook.
Right. A significant
My point
money
is,
value.
There's
wise,
no
yes.
excuse for that stuff not to be out.
It's outrageous.
And the people who are buying these, especially, I mean, I know they're not expecting, I really think that we've reached a point where there are people who are Microsoft tribe and people who are, and I'm not talking about the Jay Allard sense of tribe, but like there are people who just won't buy an Apple product or won't buy a Google product. And they're getting this, and I'm sure they think they're great, but this is not a, it's not a good product right
now. Well,
it
is. I mean, like, I may have made the analogy before, I don't remember, but it is a bit like politics in that people are tribal. They have their loyalties. Everyone, like, you know, talk about in the election right now, basically 95% of people know which way they're voting, and there's very few undecideds left in the middle. And so the war for the three app ecosystems, I think, is much the same. There are people like myself who are deeply entrenched in the Apple ecosystem. And while I'm not completely closed off, it would be very hard to get me to switch over to something else at this point. And that's equally true of people that are heavily invested in Android. And I guess to a lesser extent, Windows.
I think that analogy works only to a certain extent, because while there are zealots on both sides, like there is in the political system, I think there are far more people who are undecided when it comes to actually paying for products. And the fact that you're paying, it's not like voting. Voting, it's, you know, we want... it's
freedom isn't free, Norm.
Voting is important.
Puff Daddy says vote or die.
Voting is...
This is. I can feel Norm's going towards a point of saying that your choice of smartphone is more important than your vote.
No, I'm saying that...
maybe he's right.
If you're not in a swing state, it probably matters more.
Your choice of smartphone is absolutely not as important as your vote. Voting is extremely important. But the amount of commitment it takes to vote is much less than the amount of commitment, intangible realness of day-to-day, month-to-month. When you're committing to a smartphone... you're paying the $80, $90. Money matters a lot.
Right.
And that can affect, you know, whether someone loves Apple, adores Apple, or aspires to own an iOS device.
How tribal are you at this point? Like, what would it take for you to on the next rev go around, ditch your iPhone and get something else? What would
honestly,
need to happen?
Honestly, like Tweetbot, like a Twitter client that is equivalent to Tweetbot, if you look at what I use my phone for, it is mostly Tweetbot and like New York Times crossword and then whatever stupid iOS app is new this week, right? Whether it's Super Hexagon or
the whatever new hot iOS app is new this week part is very important, I think, right now.
Yeah. So you're saying if all things being equal, if there was app parity, you'd rather be using a Windows phone than an iPhone?
I'm saying it wouldn't matter. I wouldn't care. It would be a decision. Whereas right now, there's no decision because the iOS apps are dramatically superior.
At that point, it goes to services too, because then you're talking about iCloud and where your documents are, and which services sync well. And Microsoft has gone a long way to catch up with that.
Except a lot of it is still... this is the other thing that the phone does better than the Surface. The Surface is very Microsoft-centric. The phone is pretty egalitarian. Like, it works really well with Google and Google Calendar and all that stuff. Whereas the only way you can get files off of that thing right now are with a USB cable or SkyDrive. And most people I know aren't invested in SkyDrive.
Well, if you talk about...
I don't need another seven gigs of storage.
This is a fundamental problem with the Surface, because we are approaching it from PC users. So what you just said there... That's comparing it to a PC or a traditional laptop.
I'm going to tell you, that thing is a PC that has a touchscreen. It's not a tablet.
What Microsoft wants to, and all their advertising, what they're comparing it against and pricing it against, is an iPad.
Yeah, but that's not realistic. I mean, that's just the real world where I live, that thing is not a fucking tablet. It is a really kind of cool, thin and light touchscreen laptop. And also, you can't run x86 software on it.
They didn't commit to
and there's
one
no
side
apps.
They didn't commit to one side.
My point is, if that had come out when there were apps for it, it would be magic.
Hold on. But it is a tablet. If it looks like a tablet and feels like a tablet, it's a tablet. It's a tablet with a keyboard you can plug into it.
But what does it have? Where do you get software to run on it? What software can you run on that?
From its app store.
And what's the app? What's in the app store today?
The fact that it doesn't have a lot of apps doesn't make it not a tablet. It's just a tablet that doesn't have many apps.
It works best with the keyboard and the trackpad attached.
I don't know if that's true, is it?
I've been using it for a week.
I'm watching Norm using it right now, and he's mostly swiping and touching around on the screen.
I have not plugged a mouse into it yet.
I'm using the touchpad.
Well, you
wouldn't
need
to,
because you have the touchpad.
Right. Touchpad, I think, has been fine. And when I'm in desktop mode.
That's what I'm saying. The times I've had the best experience with that are with the keyboard attached to it, whether I'm responding to email or what. Because the landscape... the giant wide landscape screen with the huge on-screen keyboard is really fucking hard to use.
And the reason why I'm having this kind of semantic discussion is because it is a hybrid product. And it's interesting to... you're right. I think it's less interesting when it's being used as a straight up tablet, like detached from the keyboard. And more interesting when it's being used right now, like as a kind of quasi.
If I was going to jump to Surface conversation. Let's do it.
Yeah, fine. If I was going to be really cynical, what I would say is it has all of the shittiest parts of a tablet and all of the worst parts of a laptop.
So they want exactly
the opposite.
The
worst of both worlds.
Okay.
Oh.
because it does, because it's like a laptop so that doesn't run any software.
That. So the worst part of a laptop, because it is a GIMP laptop, which doesn't.
It's like
software.
A Chromebook, okay. For all intents and purposes, because except for there's apps in the Chrome App Store.
What do you think of that? We haven't spoken. What do you think of that new $250 Chromebook?
It's for like people who want a $250 laptop. Go nuts.
No.
You get exactly what you pay for.
Don't buy that Chromebook.
No. Qualified. If you want a laptop for your kid that's disposable, buy a $250 laptop for him.
If the kid is disposable, yes, get him the $250 Chromebook.
If you just want the kid,
I don't care about the kid's education.
If you just want the lightweight couch surfing computer, what's wrong with it?
I would buy a Nexus 7 for that.
Yeah.
Because there's investment. I don't think we should talk about that. We haven't tested that thing. I think the idea of Chromebooks is interesting.
And I do not like the idea of Chromebooks.
I think for kids who need laptops and you don't want to buy them all MacBook Airs,
you can't use it as a laptop.
Yeah, you can if you use Google Docs.
If you want to talk about a GIMP laptop,
it is a GIMP laptop.
That's GIMPed.
It has a web browser with a keyboard. It's a web browser with a keyboard,
and it has a real browser.
No, it's a web browser. It's Chrome with a keyboard.
Yeah, Chrome is great. IE10 crashes all the fucking time. That thing can't stay connected to Wi-Fi.
That has dropped Wi-Fi on me a couple times.
Two fucking times in like an hour yesterday. I mean, it is way too early. Shit is it just randomly restarts for no apparent reason occasionally.
If you're talking about web browsers,
the longer
the keyboard,
we talk about it, the more Will's deep dislike of this thing is really going to bubble into the surface.
It is a product that I think the frustrating thing is
that worst part of a laptop because you can't install apps,
right?
So, and then you say worst part of a tablet because
you can't fucking type with it. That keyboard is ridiculous.
You don't like both the touch and
the keyboard. No, the touch and the type keyboards are fine.
16x9.
The on-screen keyboard for 16x9 is ridiculous.
And qualify that meaning the way you hold it with two thumbs.
You end up having to hold it in one hand like this and then doing this cording
or
thing,
putting on your
which
lap,
is the worst part of keyboard typing.
Or unbalancing it on your
it's
lap.
Either
right?
too,
that doesn't
it's
work.
Either too wide or too tall. It just isn't a good ratio.
Well, no. Actually, when you're holding in portrait, it's fine. It's just too tall to actually... like it's.
And
then you end up with a nice ratio of screen to keyboard, but none of the stuff really is designed to work that way. So you end up a little
correct.
Bit weird.
And also, it is 1.5 pounds, which
it's
while
too
everyone
fucking heavy.
Is moving toward lighter, mm-hmm. Not I'm talking about price wise, but just weight wise and size wise, this is clearly a larger end of tablets.
I mean, and here's the thing: if all the stuff that doesn't work right worked right, it would be okay. Like if it stayed connected to Wi-Fi, that would be pretty awesome. If the browser would run without crashing all the time, that also would be okay. If there were a bunch of apps for it, that would be fine too, because then you'd be able to leverage the good parts of the tablet. Like the neat thing about the tablet is that you can get notifications for Facebook, right? That's useful. If you invite me to a party and I don't ever go to fucking Facebook, the only way I know about it is when my phone dings and says, hey, Gary invited me to a party. I like Gary and I like parties, so I'm going to go to Gary's party. But without apps, then there's no notifications and all you have is a really shitty laptop that can't run any x86 software. Also, there are no apps. Like, it's just all the way around. 6 months from now, I may be saying something completely different about it. But right now, no one should buy that thing. It is $500 down the toilet.
That, I mean, the reviews across the board have been
also
largely been
also
the consensus.
It's really hard to connect the power brick to it. Like it requires like it's recessed. It, like at first you look at it, you're like, oh, it's like a MagSafe. This is going to be really easy. I just get it near and pops into place. Nope, you got to fiddle it in. It's like I could use an obscene metaphor, but I'm not going to. It is a significant challenge. I do like the kickstand, though. That's nice.
I like the kickstand. Yeah. I like the look and the feel and the idea of it probably more than I would like really living with it and using it.
The hardware is really nice.
Yeah.
I mean, if there was stuff to do with it, it would be much more useful. So, yeah, Surface. Sorry. Do we want to talk about Google stuff or more about Surface?
More about Surface.
Okay.
And I want
really
to go back, to that,
Surface?
I
it's
go
the
back
big story.
To that Chrome device because I really need to use this more. And I'm going into this as someone who brings iPads to meetings and has a difficult time transcribing, taking notes on iPads.
What, you know what you need? You need a case for your iPad that has a keyboard on it.
You know
what
iPad
else,
software,
you know what
software
else you need, which you already have,
not
is a fucking MacBook Air, which... does
it's true, but I don't want
a proper laptop
and
weighs only
life,
marginally more
but
than
the battery
that.
Life. It won't go for more than 2 hours at this point for my MacBook Air, 2.5 hours at most. And when I ever take my MacBook Air to meetings and I pop it up, I'm constantly checking brightness and Wi-Fi and making all these compromises.
See, this is why I think the 13-inch MacBook Air is the superior laptop because mine lasts like 4.5 hours still. Chris is also only 3 months old or 4 months old. Anyway.
gosh, what I really wanted, and I keep on reiterating this, is the Windows great desktop experience, but incorporating the best parts of a tablet experience, which is a long battery life, which...
Battery life's really good.
Good, yeah. So
nice
far,
job,
so good.
Guys. Mission
long
accomplished.
Life, which they got that right.
I mean, part of that's because you can't really do anything with it, just to be fair.
And a great touch experience on the desktop when
yeah,
I need
everything
it.
Is a backhanded... You really, really don't like this
I haven't
thing,
had anything that I don't like at this level in a long time.
Yeah, I mean, like, it's almost like a pathological dislike.
Let's talk about...
Because the idea is pretty good. Just to be clear.
That's often what I find. The things that I dislike the most are the things where you can... The potential... It's just right...
It's Charlie Brown
it's
and
right
the football.
There, well, but you can't
that's
quite,
specific to this product.
Not quite getting it.
That's not... And part of it, I'd say maybe a quarter of it, is specific to Windows 8 and the Windows Store. Because that's a big part of RT.
Yeah. Well, if you have a closed platform that you can't install your own software on, the store had better be fucking great.
So, but there are.
And just to be clear, when the iPad launched, they had a massive benefit because you were able to use the entire back catalog of all the apps that were available for iOS on that device.
In a compromised
for the most part.
Framed
way. They were a little shittier, but at least you still got notifications, which is I think that stuff is the important
thing. It's like. The Apple Store is like Costco, right? If you said to me, you can only ever shop at Costco for the rest of your life, I'd be like, you know what? I could deal with that. They have pretty much everything I could want in my daily life.
You can get a cantaloupe there, and you can get a side of beef.
Yeah, and a fridge, and
tires.
Yeah, and liquid paper.
Yeah,
and vitamins, and everything I could possibly want.
Lotion,
Kleenex, toothpaste, Asian chicken wings. Pretty much everything you could ever want.
Peanut M&Ms.
And actually pretty good, meat and
a hot
fresh
dog,
seafood.
Pizza? Can you have lunch?
They still have the hot dog, and I think it's a soda for like $1.50.
Yeah, why would you not eat that? That's great. Nitrate sickles.
I'd be fine with that. Whereas the Microsoft Store, I guess, is more like, what, like the Goodwill? It'd be
No.
There's a store, but it's not
like
really
an ethnic.
You would
it's
want.
Like an ethnic food market. Right,
I think we should definitely really hard into this analogy. No.
I'm just saying, it's like it's got like sometimes. Some days I really want Thai food, right? I love Thai food,
but you don't want it every day.
But I don't want to eat spicy basil chicken every day for the rest of my life,
right?
So like this,
or it's like those places that just do grilled cheese, right? We all like a good grilled cheese.
I love
but if
grilled
you said
cheese.
To me like you could only eat there for the rest of your life, you'd be sick of grilled cheese fast.
If I eat grilled cheese every day for the rest of my life, they'd have to cut a hole in the side of my house to get a forklift to get me out in like 6 months.
So
that's the point.
Let me continue my thought, which is that
poor Norm.
Much of your criticism of the Surface
mm-hmm.
goes to its unrealized potential as a laptop first and with the best elements of touch and also the app stores. But there, however, are many OEMs, Windows partners, Microsoft partners, building their own Windows 8 devices, such as Lenovo, Acer, Asus, and
HP.
And HP and Dell, sure. And we do see x86 tablet hybrid computers coming out, which will run Clover Trail, which from the...
So x86 is what you're saying.
x86, so the Clover Trail running, which is the new Atom, and from the people we've talked to, performance is better than expected. At least comparable to, not as good as a full Ivy Bridge computer, but better than the Atoms we're used to, and perhaps on par with the ARM chips. Has all the battery efficiency and whatnot.
So theoretically, the best of both worlds.
Sure, can run x86 programs.
Yeah,
but maybe not full games. Doesn't have the graphics. Of course,
the games are the least of the problems.
Sure, sure. Maybe has a better form factor because not all of them are going to have this. The 10.6 inch screen.
That's the least of the problems.
And maybe has better Wi-Fi. So there could be a Windows 8 computer out there that at least addresses most of your problems that you have with the Surface, but it's not the Windows Store.
In theory, yes.
Okay.
So like if that was an x86 device, I would have an entirely different opinion of it because I would just live in the desktop and have TweetDeck and all and completely defeat the purpose of having touch. Also, the desktop is really hard to use with touch. Like they said that they made the touch points smarter and all that for the office stuff and all that. It's not. It's fucking awful.
Well, the only thing you can run on desktop is Office or the Explorer.
And the Internet Explorer.
Yeah, Internet Explorer, and Office.
Yeah. And it's hard to do with the touch.
I mean, there is there even file preview? Like the previewer?
You mean file browser?
No, the Windows preview that I love to use.
No, that's gone. Oh, that isn't in Windows. If you, on a new Windows 8 install, at least on x86, if you double click on an image, it goes to a Metro app, the Photos app.
You can right click those still.
Maybe. I don't know if it's installed though. Should we talk about Google stuff? Because they had some announcements this week, too. And kind of, kind of
oh, no, they
deal.
Did. I mean, this actually was a big week.
Yeah, so they were going to have an event on the East Coast and had to cancel it because of the hurricane. But on Monday morning, while the Windows 8 event was going on, Windows Phone 8 event was going on, they were also announcing their new Nexus phone and a 10-inch Nexus tablet.
Right.
I haven't paid any attention at all to this, Norm.
So the Nexus tablet is a Samsung 10-inch tablet. Pricing is really where...
10-inch, 16x9 again, I assume?
16x9 or 10. I think it's 16x10. It's the really super high resolution 2560x1600 tablet.
Oh, so it's a quad res. So it's their equivalent of Apple's displays. You
know, I want to confirm that before I commit to saying anything about it. The Nexus 4 is the thing that I'm a little more excited about, and that is the LG phone that, did you hear while the report that Wired made was during Octobercast, that phone also was lost at a bar in September?
Oh.
Yeah. In September in San Francisco.
They were just trying to capture that magic.
This time nobody cared. Well,
people care.
Why are we only hearing about it now then?
Because the guy kept quiet about it, except after Wired paid him a freelance fee to share the photos and share the story. And so a Google engineer lost the phone at a dive bar in San Francisco, left the phone there, did not have any, like, you know how when the iPhone 4 was lost, had this case that made it look like a 3GS cover because it was like a dummy thing.
Yeah.
This one just was bare. Looked like an LG phone. And so someone recognized it as, hey, that's the Nexus 4. Obviously, it wouldn't
curve screen.
Unlock. Wouldn't unlock or, you know, open up or anything. And the guy called Google and they had their police, you know, their Google cop guy scramble around the city looking for it. And then...
Did they ride in on a bicycle?
No, they drove around from Mountain View, and he offered the guy a free phone, basically, to return it, and he returned it. But the guy decided he could make better money with the Wired story, so got paid to do that. So the phone is interesting because you can buy it off contract, real cheap. I think $300-$350.
Yeah. So the other thing that's interesting about it is that it's a 3G phone. It's not an LTE phone.
Oh,
on
AT&T
or Verizon.
Correct.
So it's a GSM phone with the AT&T antennas in the US.
Wait, that's madness. How can it not be LTE?
I don't understand. Well, there's not really that much of an LTE network on AT&T in the US right now.
Yeah, oh, it's like
36 markets.
So this is only on AT&T?
For right now, yeah. That
sounds ridiculous.
So with the Galaxy Nexus, which was last year's Nexus phone, the Samsung one, it launched as a Samsung SKU. I mean, as a Verizon SKU. So they launched on Verizon's LTE network because Verizon required LTE for new phones on their network aside from the iPhone. My hunch is that since they rolled out on AT&T this time and 3G is a kind of more world-friendly standard, they felt like it's not important and
that
maybe
sounds
we'll
like a
see
very
an LTE
backwards
Verizon
step to me.
Phone
Come on,
next
the
year.
iPhone 5 is LTE on AT&T.
So yeah. This is Google. See, they're calling it the Nexus 4. Weird. Because is it technically the fourth Nexus?
Yeah, it's the fourth because it's the first one, the Nexus S.
But
Nexus 1, the Nexus S.
It doesn't
S,
seem like
the Galaxy Nexus.
It's also a size thing too because the Nexus 7 is a 7-inch tablet.
So this is a
Nexus
10
is a 10-inch tablet. Nexus right. 4 is a 4-inch screen. I don't think they're calling it Nexus 4 as in this is the fourth gen Nexus.
I don't give a shit what they call it. How can this not be an LTE phone?
Well, because
one of the biggest selling points of Android all along is that they had LTE before Apple and all these other guys, and now the flagship Android phone is not going to have LTE.
Because it is not the flagship
That's
Android
it.
Phone. Because it's not the fourth gen Nexus, as in this is the best thing, best next thing. It is just a Nexus phone, and that it is a stock Android phone. But now the newest Nexus is something that is affordable.
Maybe I've had it wrong. I've always clung to the idea that if I was going to get an Android phone, I would always get the official Nexus one because that has the clean OS. It's going to get the latest OS on it.
Yeah, has a clean OS.
But it isn't necessarily the one with the best specs.
Here's the thing that's changed.
Has a great screen from all reports. Has that 1.5 gigahertz processor. The only thing it doesn't have because of the physical limitations of the LG build is LTE.
So
that's crazy. I mean, that's absolute madness from my perspective.
The thing that's changed is I think that this is indicative of it's a vote of confidence in the Android ecosystem by Google. I think what this is a dev kit phone for people who want to build apps and engineers who need something to compile and test software on. And I don't think it's necessarily something that's designed to be sold at
retail. This is their open
the masses.
Phone. It's open and... It's no contract, right? $350 for the 16 gig, $300, $200 on T-Mobile. Google said that they couldn't get Verizon's approval so that they could have a stock Android phone on Verizon LTE without going through much hoops.
So I come back to my earlier question then. So I would put the Nexus 4 out of the picture.
The One X is if you're on AT&T or with Samsung Galaxy S3 maybe.
Or the S3, right.
Yeah.
I was hanging out with Cliffy B the other day, and he's gone over to the Samsung side.
Way to name drop that.
Well, I'm just saying he's the one. I'm just telling you he's the person.
How does he
I was hanging out with a friend of mine.
It's too late. You missed it.
I was hanging out with
points lost.
I was hanging out with a different friend of mine who was hanging out with me.
Yeah.
And he took all his Gears of War money and bought a Samsung Galaxy S3.
So Eric Rain.
Mark Rain.
Eric Rain. Jesus Christ.
But you know what? I actually don't. You know what? I've made a lot of jokes about it. I actually kind of like it. I do like the big screen, and I like that little flip cover thing.
The hat? The smart cover. It's not a smart cover.
Yeah, has a quote unquote smart cover that kind of flips over, a little flip case thing.
It's like a valet for your phone.
Yeah. I don't dislike it.
Quickly, the Nexus 10.
Yeah.
It is 2560 by 1600, which is the Samsung panel that we thought.
How does that compare to the Apple display?
It's high resolution.
It's actually higher?
Yeah, but it's a 16:9 versus 4:3. So
okay.
16:10.
16:10.
We don't know. I mean, I don't think it has that laminated process, and it is still relatively cheap. I think it's $350.
So this, and this of course means that Google now will be fully engaged with Apple on both fronts, the 7 and the 10 inch battlefields.
Well,
will be joined,
but they're going for price.
What's the price?
$400 for Wi-Fi 16 gig.
Right, so they're undercutting Apple by $100.
You know, theoretically, high DPI screen, high PPI screen, but we don't know what it'll look like because Samsung.
We haven't seen any 10-inch apps either.
Well, and also Samsung screens, you know, with the subpixel arrangement, could not be great with.
Well, if they're using a Pentile.
And aren't they rejigging the 7, the SKUs and the prices as well to be more competitive? Didn't I hear something about the 8?
The 8 gigabyte version went away, I think. I think it's always now, 250
but
now.
But it's now 16 and 32.
Free upgrade, enough. Like,
I don't know if it's a rumor or not, but I read something about the 16 getting pushed down to $199 is what it makes.
It is. 16 is now $199 and 32 is $250.
And that's, you know, I got to tell you, that's very compelling. I like the Nexus 7.
Is this a good point to talk about iPad mini?
Yeah, it's next on the list.
In relation to Nexus 7?
We segue into the tablet wars.
So I was going to say, the thing that's come out as the iPad mini reviews have hit, even from people who I would have thought would have been strongly anti a lower resolution, slower, whatever, iPad mini.
I will have to interrupt you there. One final thing, closing the book on the Nexus 10 and 4. They will both ship on November 13th with Android 4.2. We have a story on the site about what's new in 4.2. There's some new camera modes.
But they're still calling it Jelly Bean, which is the first time that's happened. Yeah. So I think we're seeing a newer, more mature Android.
Okay.
Which is a good thing. I think at this point, both you and I have used Android 4.1 for a while, Norm. It's really good. I mean, it is a comparable piece of software.
Could
the only
improvement.
Gap, there's always room for improvement. The gap is on software, third-party software at this point. Stuff that's in the App Store is either slower to market or
a good foundation. The search is great. Built-in search, you know, their version of Siri. Google Now could be a little better. Could be
more
useful.
You mean? Yeah. So I think what's going to happen is that the 7-inch tablets.
I can't wait to talk about it. I have thoughts about this.
Yes.
I think that the 7-inch tablet is going to dominate.
I agree.
Not the Apple one. I think 7-inch tablets are the future.
I agree. It's having,
for most people.
Things I've said since two years ago.
Now that I've used a few 7-inch tablets, I'm a believer in that form factor. And segueing into the Mini, I said this earlier before the podcast, but I think that even though the Mini is considered like the junior brother of the quote unquote real 10-inch iPad.
Yeah.
I think over time, people are going to gravitate towards the Mini. It's going to be more popular,
just like the Air,
and the full iPad will be considered kind of like the iPad XL, like the jumbo size.
Well, just like a MacBook Pro and a MacBook Air.
Yeah. Absolutely.
So the reviews were pretty universal. I've only read a couple of them because I didn't need to read any 5,500 word treatises. But what I did read, pretty much everybody said, look, if this had a Retina screen, it would be perfect.
Right. But as is, the reviews have been very strong.
The reviews have been very good.
Verge gave it, what, a 9? And TechCrunch.
Gruber was really kind, as always.
Yeah. But all the reviews have
been
good. The
people I've talked to that have had them said positive things.
While we're talking about reviews, yes, the universal consensus is it is extremely light, easy to hold, but the screen is what you'd expect from the iPhone 3GS screen, meaning it doesn't look as on the surface as LCD is not laminated to the surface like it is on the iPhone 5 or 4S even. It looks like a 3GS screen recut to be bigger,
But it seems like
7.9.
Reviews have been quite forgiving of that.
you know what I hate? I hate the reviews like, I was wrong. I was wrong about 7-inch tablets. And now that Apple's showing me the way.
Right.
Now I'm a believer.
They could have figured that out by playing with, like, the Nexus 7, right?
Fuck that shit. I hate the, I'm wrong. This is the one thing I'll admit to being wrong for.
This is why,
because Apple was right all along.
This is why people who hate Apple hate Apple, is because shit happens, but it only gets acknowledged when Apple does it.
Yeah. Yeah.
That's true.
Right? Fuck that. No. Oh, God.
I mean, the thing is, a 7-inch tablet solves the problems with iPad. The iPad 3 is too heavy. We've been saying, well, I've been saying that for ages.
Yes,
you guys
you
made all sorts of limp-wristed judgments.
Qualified for too heavy for the way you're using it, which is you want to read ebooks on it.
Yeah,
not too heavy for the way I use it, which is I sit down and I browse photos. It is lying on the bed with me on a pillow and I browse photos.
I'm telling it's funny, even after using the Nexus 7, only
By that logic, it could weigh 100,000 pounds, and as long as it doesn't collapse the floor
But I can lift it from the charger from my desk to the pillow.
Let me get my block and tackle to lift this up off the bed.
It's mobile.
But I'm telling you, my regular iPad is already starting to feel heavier.
Could it be lighter?
Sure.
Just from
using the Nexus 7, just from using the 7-inch Kindle Fire, from using my regular Kindle, this is like, yeah, these tablets are actually pretty big and heavy.
When I look at that, what I want is that thing in Star Trek that they're just walking around and they're like, oh, here you go, here's a pad.
That's what the Nexus 7 is, the replica prop for $60. You want to buy it?
No, I want an iPad.
I think that certainly it'll start with this generation, but the next generation, when they presumably get Retina in there, that the Mini... And 7-inch tablets in general will be, as far as the general public is concerned, the porridge is just right at that size, at that weight. That's what they really want.
So, okay, long story short, we don't know. Reviews are really positive of the Mini. It's out tomorrow.
Yeah, we're going to go get some.
I'm like an asshole. What is it called when you have deja vu? I'll be in line again. Gary, are you coming out?
Well, and I'm going to have the worst deja vu of all, because I very specifically came out and said, I don't need this thing. I like the idea of it, but I don't need it. My computing needs aren't so granular that I really need something between this tablet and this one. And like, if I just had one that was half inch smaller,
it's the 7th screen.
But it is.
This is for the master bathroom, and then this is for the chud bathroom,
exactly.
And then this one's for the kitchen sink next to the read menus,
while I'm in the drive-in line at McDonald's waiting for my Big Mac.
The reality is, the thing is though, tablets, you can always find room for extra ones. Like, this one just gets plugged into the sound dock and becomes a base station for kinds of things that you have in the kitchen. And, you know, like, I'm going to give one to my parents. I may give them a Mini, or I may give them my old iPad 2 or iPad 3 and just use a Mini, or whatever it may be. I don't know. But yes, I have once again been a complete
eating
hypocrite.
Your word. You were wrong, Gary.
And I will be in line with you tomorrow.
You're
going to get a black or a black one or a white
one? I'm going to get whatever they have, because it's for the site.
You should get a black one.
I'm going to get a white one.
I think that tablets should be white.
Yeah,
that's my general rule.
And phones should be black.
Now
that's how I feel.
Now,
oh wow! And says a guy with a white phone.
Do you think there will be?
I did that for you.
Do you think there'll be big lines tomorrow? Like there have been.
I have no idea. I'm not going to get up at 4 o'clock in the morning.
That really is a big question. This is a product that it is an iteration of the iPad family, but it is not a new category, as in the phone and the tablet are separate categories.
I think if this was the high end, then yes, there would be people in line.
Aside from you,
no,
Gary,
I think the fact that it's a lower end is going to drag more people out, people that felt like they were priced out of this before.
I think that they probably have a living shitload of these in Apple stores around the country right now. I don't think that there's going to be a shortage of these. I think that we had shortage of iPhone 5, and that probably got up in Tim Cook's crawl.
Given
remember,
that
he's the logistics guy.
Given that it's probably easier to make these lower grade panels.
Yeah.
Yeah, I think they'll be fine.
There's nothing in this. It's an old CPU that they've figured that out. They've been making it on small wafers
for a long time. It's like they basically found a bunch of old shitty parts that were just lying around from...
Yeah, it's the Frankenpad.
Yeah, and they're going to turn that into another money spinner.
But the limiting factor, and while it is a lot of old parts, screens, CPU, memory included, right? The stuff that's going to hold them back is the chassis. Now, the chamfered edge of the chassis, just like they did have production problems on those.
That's why I'm getting the white one again, because I'm not having Scuffgate twice in a year.
And they did say, unless they're clearly lying to us, they said they were a true mark of a victim. They were at the top of the cost curve.
Scuff
right now
me once, shame
for this,
on
for this
shame
p-
on you.
Product. So even the components individually, they might be able to produce them by in bulk with high yields and low cost. Overall, for this product, they are still at the top of that cost curve, if we are to believe what they told analysts during that call.
Yeah.
The conference
call. They don't lie to analysts.
At the top of that cost curve, the production is still not going to be as smooth as it is 3 months in, 4 months in.
We'll see.
So what do you think? In 6 a.m.?
Probably 6. Yeah. Probably get up at 6.
Yeah. Oh, that's so sad. Less sad for Will.
You should go wait in line for this one.
Less sad for Will. More sad for Gary.
Yeah, I wouldn't do this
for me.
I'm not going and doing this except for
you're like
work.
Right out of the woman's shelter.
Don't make a battered woman joke.
Whoa.
Storm chaser is the right analogy there. Microsoft Build's going on. Hold on. Quick to hit on the iPhone, iPad 4. We're not going to bother getting one. It is a straight spec bump.
Yeah, I mean, it's interesting, isn't it? They did announce it as like the new iPad, but like it really just felt like barely a hair above a stealth update.
So let me speak to everyone who owns an iPad 3 and maybe even owns an iPad 2.
Hold on, do you want me to zoom
look,
in?
Even and, like, look, and this norm. Is the true limit, and I will actually stand by this. Even I am not upgrading my 3 to a 4 because one is that
just
crazy.
Just an off the cuff. Appeal to my fellow iPad 3
owners. To the camera. My fellow Americans.
My fellow iPad 3 owners. We bought the iPad 3 in March this year. We have a grand 6 months of Retina quality on the iPad 3. There is no reason to be sad about this fourth generation iPad being released a mere 6 months later.
Unless
what this means to you and me, my fellow iPad 3 Retina display owners, is that next year, next winter, we will get an 18-month upgrade that will far surpass what those who are buying the iPad 4th gen right now will get.
Unless you really, really need an iPad that is faster than the one you have now. And really, is anyone complaining about speeds on the iPad 3?
No.
And will not work with any of your existing docks or accessories. Yeah. If that's something you really need in your life.
Actually, it will work with all of my existing docks and accessories because now I have 2 docks, but don't upgrade iPad 3s.
And even if you own an iPad 2, this iPad 4 is like the 4 to 4S for the iPhone 4.
It's the Verizon iPhone 4.
I haven't heard a single...
I would say it's a 4S.
I haven't heard a single person saying that they're going to trade their 3 in for a 4. I've heard people say they're going to trade their 3 in for a mini because they actually want the smaller thing.
But even if you have a 3, if you're not going to trade in for a 4, which is a no-brainer, don't feel bad about it. It's a good thing. It means that the upgrade cycle for you is even shorter.
It's actually
it's longer, you mean. It's either
waiting 2 years, you're waiting 18 months.
And they've made it really easy to skip it this year.
Yeah, it's a no-brainer.
It is a no-brainer.
So, and if you were planning on getting an iPad for Christmas or something like this already, it's also a no-brainer. Go ahead, because you're going to have until next Christmas before they update again.
Right.
There's very unlikely to be a March launch. Although, the thing we've all learned from this is that with Apple, you never fucking know. They might get crazy.
Yeah.
Like they might release the iPhone 6 tomorrow.
Well, speaking of Apple
iPhone 6 rumors start here.
Speaking of Apple getting crazy, do you also want to talk about all the internal drama?
Let's spread it out a little bit because we're actually running real short on time. I've only got about 20 minutes left.
Okay.
Holy crap.
Yeah, well, it took us a while to get going and, you know, we did a 24-hour podcast earlier this week and things.
Yeah, this seems like nothing now.
Build's happening right now. Windows 8 sales?
Yeah, 4 million in the first 4 days.
Is that good?
Well, you know, compared to, if you want to say in sheer numbers, you can call that compared to macOS upgrade. Sure, it's comparable in terms of sheer numbers. But
compared to their market size,
it is a third of 1%.
Especially since they cut the price by a massive fraction.
And they also count this not as people who upgraded via Windows Store. It's 4 million, including shipped OEMs and partners. So I don't know how much more they can spin this, but Windows 8, I have not used it enough to say whether...
Have you put it on your computer yet?
I have not put it on my computer yet.
Homework is to put Windows 8 on your computer.
I'm getting a Windows 8 computer to use as my primary computer soon.
Yeah, but you have to put it on your gaming machine and live with it, and it's a real thing. For realsies.
It's not that a format and backup and everything. Yeah, sure. It is a wait and see.
Yeah.
It is absolutely a wait and see right now.
Well, and the improvements you get for a PC user are incremental.
Now, there are ways, like, you know, we've talked to Lloyd, and he says the start screen doesn't bother him anymore. He uses it like...
I would agree with that.
And he uses it like you do the start menu. You know, you hit the start menu, and you start typing. And yes, you can't see your desktop while you're searching.
That's fine.
Yeah, some people don't need that. I would like that. I'll probably use a start menu replacement. And for gaming, whatever, it's the core functionality is going to be very similar to Windows 7 for desktop users.
The only things that are annoying are the charms, really. And they're fucking hard to use if you're on a mouse and keyboard.
You don't have to use the charms.
You do sometimes.
For using the Windows.
To sign out, you have to use them.
Sure, for powering out, for changing Wi-Fi stuff, you're going to have to use the charms.
Yeah.
The advantages, though, because even on the desktop, for example, i.e. in an Explorer on the desktop, having a touchscreen. So I don't have a touchscreen at home for my desktop. You don't.
Yeah, no.
But
normal people don't.
And we are seeing a lot of these all-in-ones being sold with touchscreens
and
now.
We're going to see a bunch of really shitty things that are like aftermarket clip-on things that make your normal display touch friendly.
It is really making me want that laptop with the best that the tablet can offer. A real laptop. X86 laptop.
Well, is that closer to the sort of thing that Darren brought in?
Kind of.
It attaches?
Yeah. But I don't even need that tablet. I don't even need to hold it as a tablet. Like, for example, the yoga, right? I'm only going to use that in the laptop pose. Right, I'm only going to use a keyboard mode and use it as a real PC. There are air quotes for people who aren't watching, but I want to be able to touch the screen for browsing. Like I'm in IE right now, and I'm in my mind this is a laptop because I'm in desktop IE.
Yeah,
but then I instinctively went to the screen and scrolled up and down using my finger.
That's the language now.
Yep. And because that is a language that I've adopted from using a tablet.
Yep. Yeah, and just to be clear, using the Surface in that kind of vertical standing mode like a laptop. My arm doesn't get tired swiping touch screens or anything like that.
Because you're mostly still resting on the keyboard.
Yeah, normally your hand's in your lap or whatever, and then you reach up and swipe, and then you reach up and swipe. And it's not like you're using the force to hold your arm out for reading, right?
You can still use the arrow keys. Yeah.
We've got a ton of stuff to get through, so I think we got to move on.
Touch should be a complement to all the things that we already know from 20 years.
But I don't want
computing.
A thicker, heavier laptop as a result. I want the lightest laptop I can get that has good battery life. I mean, I'm just saying I'm not interested in getting a huge laptop just so I can get touch.
God. Okay. All right.
Conversation for another day. Yes. Let's talk about Lucasfilm, because this is a huge deal.
I forgot that was on the list.
Yeah. I mean, we could kill the remaining time talking about Lucasfilm. Do we want to save this for fake outtakes, actually? Or do we want to just intersperse the fake outtakes liberally throughout the show?
I kind of feel like everything that's been... I actually had to turn my Twitter off. Obviously, it's huge news, but like it got so over... It is a massive, massive story. But it's almost been so overreported that like I don't have anything to add.
Did you see the video of Darth Vader going to Disneyland?
That was actually a rehash. They had filmed that footage for a previous
Star Tours or something?
For Star Tours, where Darth Vader visited Disneyland. Everything was closed. And then they used that footage again and recut it.
It was a good video. I like Darth Vader riding the teacups.
The basics, $4.05 billion, all going to 100% going to George Lucas himself.
Or someone pointed out, four Instagrams.
But also one half of Pixar.
Right.
Because Disney bought Pixar for over $7
billion. So Kotke said, why was it so cheap? And I think that the reason it was so cheap. Yeah, they got a steal.
They got a steal at $4.05 billion.
Because the thing is, like each of those prequel movies made less than the one before.
Regardless, I mean, you know why? Because the quality of it was crap.
No,
and
I think know.
The anticipation for Star Wars 7 when that come out is going to blow everything, maybe not Avengers 2, but everything out of the water that summer.
So I mean,
it's going to make $1 billion easy.
Really? You think Charlie Brown's going to line up for the football one more time?
And sad though, is to say the fact that it's actually under different stewardship is what people are going to be excited about.
I mean, I am excited about that. I'm excited about the fact that George Lucas can't change those fucking movies anymore.
And the fact that we're getting more information about like Lucas's original plans now, that like they have to justify this to people by releasing the documents.
So you saw the documents with the outline for the 12-story arc.
Two-page long notepad that said
legal pad
that said episode 1 to 12 with everything blank.
Yeah, it was just like numbers
and next
big
to 12
blanks.
When the notation said conclusion.
Yeah, it was a loose outline.
That was one of the many pieces. He has a private journal that has only been available to his biographer.
Okay.
and other people, and I think Mark Hamill has seen it. I'm excited for a new Star Wars movie.
Here's what I'm excited for. I'm excited for the fact that Disney is going to try to exploit that franchise as hard as they can. That means that we're going to see original trilogy released on Blu-ray and restored.
No, because
the original movies aren't covered.
They're not covered. Fox owns the rights to 4, 5, and 6, four in perpetuity, forever. And
does that mean Fox can do it now?
And 5 and 6 goes to Lucasfilm, which means goes to Disney in 2020. And so unless Disney makes a deal with Fox. And Disney and Fox do not have a great relationship because of the Marvel stuff right now. I mean, it's easy money for Fox. They could,
yeah.
They take a, you know,
I would buy
cut.
Episode 4 of the original. I'd be totally fine with that. That would make 4 and 5.
There's still
four,
a possibility.
I mean, whatever, it works.
It's Hollywood.
I think it's not a bad thing. I think that there's no way that they can make Star Wars worse than George Lucas did.
I think there are very valid reasons why the reaction to this has mostly been very positive.
The thing Matt Honan said on Twitter was, what, Disney's going to ruin Star Wars? Said somebody who's been unconscious since 1998.
1988.
1998.
Wow.
Prequel came out in 1999. Yeah, I think it's a good thing. I'm excited.
I think people have a lot of faith in Disney. They've
done right by Pixar.
They've done right by Marvel.
Minus Cars.
Except for Cars. But
and the thing we've
you
all...
You know what? If they do the Affleck and let them and make them do a money film and then a real film and then a money film and then a real film, I'm fine with that.
And here's what a lot of Star Wars fans have done already. They love the universe. They love the franchise. But you can be picky about what you like about it. You don't have to love it all. Like, there are a lot of things...
I don't love the extended universe.
Yeah, well, a lot of people only love the extended universe. Yeah. And even within the Clone Wars stuff, there are parts of the Clone Wars, like the animated stuff,
that I like. Yeah, the Gennady Tartar.
And part of the stuff that I don't like. And, you know, you pick and choose.
Yeah, that's exactly right.
It's a wealth I think people are excited about the fact that there will now be a lot more Star Wars coming. That Star Wars is going to be re-energized in a way... It's obviously been allowed to kind of lay fallow for a long time. And I think there'll be a fresh wave of... money and energy and creative talent that was not there before will go into this, and it's still a fantastic universe, and everyone's rightly excited.
Somebody pointed out that the amount of time between Jedi Return of the Jedi and Phantom Menace is going to be the same as the amount of time between Phantom Menace and Episode 7.
Well, I told you the other day when somebody pointed out to me that that Mark Hamill is now older than Alec Guinness was in the first Star Wars is nutty.
Yeah. Yeah, so that's happened. Apple exec, there's been some drama in the ranks at Apple. Scott Forstall's out. Bennett, the guy who runs Apple Stores, ran Apple Stores is out.
I wonder why the retail guy's out.
Well, he didn't do anything. I mean, he's been to be honest, he's been there for
since April.
Less than a year.
Yeah.
So he hasn't had a full holiday season to do anything at the Apple Stores. But he never seemed like the right fit. Like his past, he ran what, Dixon's,
the Kmart, right, or JCPenney's?
No.
JCPenney's where the old guy went.
The other way. Ron Johnson, left
it's
Apple.
An awesome name
to work to run JCPenney, which he hasn't had a huge success with.
No, he's trying though.
He's trying.
Bunch of new shit.
And the guy who Tim Cook hired to replace him previously ran I think it was a UK or a Canadian electronics.
Oh, that's right.
Chain.
He's the Tesco guy.
And it was never. He never seemed like a guy who could bring new ideas. It
didn't work out. Forstall is the bigger story, though, because he's been in charge of iOS
since
the
inception.
He's really
the most high-profile scalp, right? I mean, this is the guy that we all know from the keynotes and Apple videos. This is a very high-profile guy.
So there's been a lot of scuttlebutt about this, and the rumor is that he was trying to build kingdoms inside iOS. He's one of the big proponents of the skeuomorphic app design.
Which there's been an increasing trend against, it seems, like in the public... Certainly in the blog world and just generally, people are becoming increasingly... unhappy with the idea of skeuomorphic.
Even both Johnny Ive.
Both on iOS.
And iOS is the most aggressively skeuomorphic thing there is in the world.
And even if you look at the Android post 4.0 and the Windows Phone stuff, the rest of the market is moving away from that. So Johnny Ive, as Norm's getting ready to say.
Yeah, Johnny Ive had been very dismissive of, it would not defend skeuomorphic design. He was asked about it and he would just... Yeah, I kind of shrugged, said, that's...
Not my thing.
Yeah, exactly. He was never in charge of that. Well, guess what?
Now
he's
in charge of it.
Do you think... I have tremendous respect for Johnny Ive. I mean, I think he's a very incredibly smart guy. I mean, he has to be. Mm-hmm. But do you think that his expertise in industrial design will translate into software design?
You know, that's a very good question.
And
because
user experience?
Software design and user experience are... Like UI and UX are very different things. Mm-hmm. And... I would say maybe for UI, you would see a little of the nitpicky details are going to all be.
I think it's the frames.
Nicer, but in terms of experience and what happens when you actually click buttons and goes between menus and stuff, that will be
the UX. The UX, the experience
that's more
is
aligned
the same.
On software, and I think he probably has a better working relationship with Eddie Q and the software guys than Scott Forstall.
Do you think iOS 7 will seem like a bigger change now that they've changed people at the top?
They delayed iTunes 11 till the end of November, which gave them basically an extra month and a half. Right. It wouldn't surprise me if we see hints in that. I mean, if you're talking about something that's a reskinned UI, then my hunch is that we'll see some gradual changes in iOS 7 and then dramatic changes in iOS 8 and probably some harbingers later this year and early next with like equivalents to the podcasts app and those kind of mid-release updates. Maybe the wood shelves and iBooks are going to go away. Maybe the newsstand stuff will change next time. But I think the days of the linen background on the notifications window, of the leather and Find My Friends,
you know, linen background,
all that
never,
stuff's going to go away.
So, well, and the really so aggressive consistent stuff like the podcast app looking like an old tape machine, yeah, and stuff like that.
Yeah, in the future, you're going to have to, iTunes 11, you actually had to take a LP off of a shelf and drag and drop it onto the turntable and put the needle on.
I'm surprised we don't have to, like, you know, actually like rotary dial on our iPhones, you know, like for the ultimate, yeah, skeuomorphic experience.
A lot of people give this crap. The linen background on notifications never,
it's the least
me
bad
it
does, thing.
It doesn't bother me at all. But where it gets more aggressive is in places like Game Center, where, yeah, yes, people get really upset.
Or a calendar.
Notes. Yeah.
But there, yeah, was, but having no textured background, like for example, when you shift between tabs in Safari.
Well, most apps do a color gradient.
I hate that color gradient.
I mean, iOS does a color gradient. I don't like it. There's other ways to do it.
I think you can be much prettier than that. Some skeuomorphic stuff does work. For example, the new clock app for iPad.
Wrong.
You don't like the new clock app?
I like that it's very designy and fancy and all that. It's just make a fucking digital clock, man.
I don't have a problem with skeuomorphism in theory. I think like any design discipline, there are good examples and bad examples. I think it's wrong to reject it. You just as a principle.
If the skeuomorphic design isn't the best way to present for the interface that you're using, which in this case is touch, and most skeuomorphic design is designed to have tactile feel, knobs and buttons and things like that. When you're transitioning from a touch interface to a tangible physical interface, it's not a good choice.
So I think it's, I don't know what the machinations behind it are, but I do think that we are maybe not so much as consumers, maybe starting to see the very, very beginning of it. But I think certainly within Apple,
yeah,
Tim Cook and maybe some other higher up people are beginning to sense the start of post Jobs stagnation.
It's not,
and they feel like they need to kind of shake things up.
I don't think it's that they need to shake things up. I think it's that they're, you know, one of the things that's interesting about Apple as a company is that they have always, they don't have organization. There's no P&L for different divisions, right? There's a P&L for Apple. And if there's people doing kingdom buildings, building kingdoms inside Apple, that's bad for Apple, mm-hmm, and bad for the people who buy Apple products. I think that's what this is about.
Right. Right.
And I think the skeuomorphic design is just a happy
is it like the mafia, like the mafia boss that sees like the lieutenant under him is like making, yeah, making some aggressive moves, and you've got to take him out before,
yeah,
he, one
Joe Pesci's
he takes
skimming 5%, and, yeah, you got to fucking fix that, or else everybody's going to skim 5%.
Yeah,
it's just like in
Tim Cook's Robert De
Niro. Like if Prop Joe had taken Marlowe more serious,
yeah,
back in the day,
then what's his name? Then his nephew wouldn't have killed him.
I like the idea of reimagining the
cheese.
Apple's corporate
cheese
structure as the Wire.
Who's cheese? Forstall's cheese.
You think he's cheese?
Yeah.
I'm going to play some music, and then we're going to talk about what we've been testing.
Hold on a minute. Let's cast the Apple.
Will really needs to see
executive
the Wire
team.
So that you
I've
can
never watched
watch
the Apple.
Really
on the
need
Wire
to watch the Wire. So you can have these conversations.
I don't know when it's going to happen now.
Yeah, you're screwed at this
point. Fucked.
Gates,
well,
is,
you know,
like Omar.
You know, we didn't revisit that great piece of news that you delivered during October. You just dropped it in there like it was nothing.
I like to do
you
that.
Do you want to drop it again for
well,
the benefit
of people? Well, I'm having a
kid. It's amazing.
Yeah.
It's amazing.
Miracle of life.
Yeah, well, you know, it's happening a lot. I don't know what happened in the whiskey media water there at the end, but between Vinny, yeah, and some other people I don't think we can talk, yeah, about yet, it's fucking unbelievable.
Yeah, and I just used to visit.
Yeah, you were just there once a week.
It was enough for me.
That little room.
Something in that coffee machine.
It's the ball sweat room in the basement there, the podcast room.
And everyone's going to have twins.
I'm not having twins.
Okay. It is unfortunate timing that it's going to seriously impact your chances of going to CES.
No, you know, yeah.
Wait, what is that? What, are you going to try and pull it off anyway?
He's not geeky.
No. I mean, if I go, I'll go for the day.
You're saying you're not bothered
CES? I'm saying I think that this is going to be the least interesting CES in CES in a long time.
No, okay.
Microsoft. I think this is the end for CES probably.
Okay.
You know, it's funny because when we were driving the van back last year and you were playing music, it was Wes was in the way back of the van and Norm was in like the third seat and Gary was in the second seat.
That was a good trip.
And you were just like playing albums and I was just driving. And I was like, man, we should really be fucking treasuring this moment because it's never going to be the same again.
Yeah.
And then you knocked up Leah and I knocked
it's
up
like
Gina.
It's like singing Tiny Dancer and the two of us are Almost Famous.
That's exactly it. And then you play Tiny Dancer. I was like, this is such a good song.
I'm a golden god.
It'll never be this good again.
Yeah. It's on top of the planet.
I'm probably stupid.
I killed a guy in Kansas City.
I don't care if Vegas is, if CS is no good, because I don't even go. I just use an excuse to go to Vegas.
Well, if you want, what we can do is set up the green screen here and we'll just pipe our feed into the CS show. It'll be like we're just sitting there.
Wonderful.
Yeah, just what we wanted.
Brilliant.
Mid-January, having a baby girl. So we're really excited.
Very excited about
it. Gina and I had been trying for a long time. We'd seen a lot of medical specialists. We never really talked about this in the show, but I'm going to go ahead and tell you, if you ever go to the urologist and they say, hey, is it okay if students observe your what's it called when you go to the doctor and you get checked out? They have a medical
physical
term.
Exam?
No, examination.
Okay.
The answer is always no. Right. Always
you,
say no.
Never
say yes at the urologist.
Yeah.
Sometimes they don't ask.
Never
so,
say yes to a urologist. That's a good. That's
can
a good
you
one.
Tell them that you're uncomfortable?
No, I don't think so. Really? I think they were just saying. I think they were giving me the option to let me know, to warn me in advance.
And you're not that, even the subject of it.
No, I was the subject of the examination at the urologist.
Oh right. Oh, you had to go as well.
Yeah.
Oh, I see.
We'd been trying to have kids for like three.
Oh, I
long
see.
Time.
So you were getting your junk.
Everybody at some point in the fertility testing process, everyone gets their junk inspected.
Right. And you can talk about this now. Because
what are the reactions? Do doctors have like comforting, huh? Or huh? what are the sounds?
Are they actually watching
makes?
You while you're like whacking off into
no,
a jar?
No.
Because
no,
that would be
that's a bit far. Yeah. No, they don't. They don't inspect your
like
whacking.
One of them's
technique.
Holding the magazine up.
Like
for
here,
you?
Squirt a little lotion.
Yeah.
No, they so when you go to the urologist, you go in and you're standing there, and it's not like you're sitting on the thing. They're just like stand up, you know, drop your shorts, whatever.
Yeah,
it's fine. So first, I've never seen that before. At this point, you're just thinking, wow, this is really unusual. I'm not used to standing here in front of a grown man with my shorts off, but this is fine. And then, so the way it worked was, first you see the resident checks everything out, and then the real doctor comes. When the real doctor came, he said, oh, is it okay if some students come in? And I was like, okay, whatever. And I thought I'd already done all of the shorts dropping I was going to need to do at this point.
Right.
So in Trump, about maybe, I don't know, it seemed like it was probably two dozen, but it was probably like eight people.
Yeah.
And they were all maybe 15.
Yeah.
So they're like med students.
Yeah.
Maybe first year med students.
Male and female?
Almost all female.
Does that make it worse?
Much, much worse.
Okay.
Much, much worse. And also, like, I don't know. Like they looked like they were maybe 18 on the outside. Like it was a bunch of fucking kids.
Right.
So we get there and he's like, do you mind drop your shorts again? I'm like, what? Wait, really? Again? There's like fucking 20 people in here. This is uncomfortable. So anyway, yeah, that was my urologist story. It wasn't good.
Now, did any of the stories, the horror stories that me and Vinny told you during Oktobercast, were you able to just kind of roll with those or?
They're all gone.
It seemed like they affected Norm more than they did
Merconium.
You.
Merconium.
Yeah, the Merconium story.
I think
you
I was getting
like
food when that happened.
Yeah.
When you talked about Merconium.
Probably
I already knew
best.
About that.
Yeah.
We're signing up for all those classes now, though. Like between getting the baby's room ready and taking the birthing classes, the breastfeeding classes, the post-infant care, the newborn care, all the different classes we have to take. I don't have any weekends
yeah,
anymore.
Yeah, I just remember, I mean, by all means, absorb it all, but take it all with a pinch of salt to some degree. I probably ended up forgetting or not using 90% of the stuff I learned in those classes. Because once the shit starts flying, literally, you realize you're pretty much on your own.
Well, it seems like support the baby's head.
Yeah.
Put the car seat in good.
Yeah.
Make sure you have the appropriate safe bed and all that stuff at home for the child.
Yeah.
And then the rest of it just kind of works itself out.
Yeah, it figures itself out. Yeah. It's not as difficult as we made it sound. One of the great joys about being a dad is terrifying dads to be with exaggerated stories about how scary things can get.
So it didn't seem that scary. I mean, Vinny seems like, I think Vinny might hate his kid. I'm not sure.
Well, I thought it was very telling when I said to Vinny, I do the thing and he said, well, dad's like, yeah, but the same thing, no matter how bad it gets, like, you'd never take it back, right? I mean, it's like you're always
he
happy.
Really thought about
like,
it for a long time.
I don't know, maybe.
That's just Vinny being Vinny.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's Vinny.
No, he loves it.
What else have we been testing, guys?
I've been playing Need for Speed Most Wanted.
Okay.
Very excited about that. I love those Need for Speed games.
This is a Criterion one again,
just got the new one last night. Yeah, and I love Criterion. I mean, they should just... They should just make Criterion 50 times bigger and just have them develop all racing games ever.
I want Burnout. I just want more Burnout.
I kind of wish they would go back to Burnout. Like this, like Need for Speed Most Wanted is great, and it's like got all the open world stuff we love about Burnout Paradise. But it's just not as much. Like the Need for Speed franchise has always been a bit more buttoned down and takes itself a little bit more seriously than Burnout. Burnout is just like whatever it takes to have a good time. That's what we're doing, and we don't give a shit about anything else.
I mean. It seems like I think that's what they have on their whiteboards is how can we make this more fun?
It's like fun every time there's a fun choice. At any cost has always been kind of the mantra of the Burnout games.
When I showed people who didn't play games Burnout, and I guess it was Burnout Revenge, probably the one with the car checking, my mom and sister who like my sister's super
traffic
into Forza,
checking was just the best.
See, traffic checking broke that game.
No, that was the best part of it.
My sister who's super into Forza, I was like, she's gonna love Burnout. It's fucking awesome.
Right.
She thought I was a sociopath. Like she looked at me playing that, and she's like, "Why are you crashing all? The whole point is to not crash the cars. Why are you doing? Well, why are you killing all these people?"
Whichever the first one that had the crash mode in it,
that was three.
My roommate at the time would play that game, and she's like, "I don't know how you can play these violent car crashing games. Like, there's something wrong with you. You're a juvenile." And then like she would sit down on the couch next to me and be like, "Oh, crash that one into that because like it's just universally excellent.
There's the bonus.
You want to see the physics?
Yeah. Crash Breaker. Yeah. So it's fun." But I don't think it's as good as as Paradise and some of their heights that they hit with the Burnout game.
Paradise.
I understand why they went. Need for Speed is where the money is. That's the franchise. Yeah. But it's just, you know, it's not as much all-out fun, but it still captures
a lot. Does it have the same autolog stuff and all that?
Still has autolog.
Okay.
So it's like, Will has just beaten your time. You better go over there and get him back. And it's like, you definitely have that. All the social features are great.
Is this open world?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. So it's a whole city, just like Paradise City was in Burnout.
Or like Most Wanted too, right?
But much, much better version of an open city. Lots of great races, lots of great social features. Do I wish they were just making Burnout games? Yes, but...
In
the absence of that, this is the next best thing. What?
Does it have like a destruction model on the cars? Because I know they're all licensed cars.
You can beat them up. But okay. And some of the crashes, like, you know, when you're going like a million miles an hour and you just fucking T-bone a truck and that crash feels really satisfying, they still have all that great stuff.
Okay.
And they have takedowns. I mean, they have full on takedowns, putting cars into the wall, pit maneuvers. They have all the stuff that we love about Burnout. It's all in there. It's just, I don't know. There's that little bit of Burnout magic is missing, but for the most part, it's the most fun driving game on the market probably right now, I would say.
So I've been testing the Surface RT.
Have you? What do you think of it? You actually been using it?
Yeah, okay. I use it at night instead of the iPad.
All right.
And I've used it a little bit at
work. I don't think that's the way to use it.
How the fuck do you think I should use it?
Use it as your computer as opposed to...
Well, then they shouldn't have made it detachable.
Do you want me to just not do anything
if they
this
don't
week?
Want you to use it just as a tablet, they shouldn't have made it detachable.
If you would like me to be completely unproductive, I can totally do that.
Well.
More so than normal.
I'm just waiting for that X86 Pro.
The X86
What are you downloading there?
HD video of Xbox.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Xbox movies. What have you been testing?
I was supposed to get a SIM card. Clipper thing, a new one, but that didn't turn out well.
No,
it's only $5.
We got some business cards.
Cut the nanosins. Yeah, we visited a bunch of places. I can't talk about this yet.
Okay,
I can't talk about stuff yet.
Don't talk about this yet.
I've been continuing to test my Kindle Paperwhite. I love it. Still one of my favorite devices.
It's fantastic.
Yeah, nothing bad to say about it.
I've been experimenting more with painting and finishing 3D printed stuff. We'll have video for that tomorrow.
Okay.
But yeah, people should check that out. I've been doing a lot of video processing this week. We used this cool thing that Giant Bomb loaned us that lets us compress video, 2 hours of video in about 20 minutes instead of the normal 2 or 3 hours. And then we had the levels going into that too low. So I had to recompress all of the podcast, all of the Octobercast video, which is about 2 hours per and then another 2 hours to upload per. That takes a long time.
Oh, and just as a very small thing, because there was some confusion about this when they first announced it, I finally got one of those Lightning to 30-pin dot connector adapter cables so that I could run the
I think we talked about
audio
this
through
my computer.
It does. There was some confusion about whether or not audio would pass through. It totally does.
So what's happening though? There's no analog out in the 8-pin Lightning connector. Previously, iPhones were able to send analog audio straight out. They don't do that anymore. Those adapters have a very tiny DAC, which is a digital to audio convert, analog converter.
So, I mean, Apple's very proud of itself for rolling out all these different new Lightning cables for everything. HDMI, AV, everything you could want, you can now plug it in.
But they've completely fucked up their ecosystem in the process.
Well, and so, yeah, like, part of the reason why I wouldn't want an iPad 4 right now is it won't. I like to put my iPad in the speaker dock I have in the kitchen and listen to music on it. Can't do that with the new one unless I get the adapter. And for all I know,
sticks it up.
Yeah, and, it might be kind of wobbly on the adapter. Yeah. I don't know.
On the adapters, it's worth paying for the one that's $10 more and then just lay it flat beside the dock.
But Bose and Griffin and all the Belkin, all these people that make these speaker docks and nights, you know, alarm clocks and things. That there's a huge cottage industry built around plugging your iPod and your iPhone and your iPad into these music docks.
Yeah,
I don't know what's going on inside these companies, but they must be pulling their hair out because it sounds like Apple is very, very slow in assisting them in making a new range of things that will actually be compliant with. Can you remember as of tomorrow?
Yeah.
Aside from the iPad 2, Apple won't be making any dock devices anymore. Everything now will have a Lightning connector on it.
Yeah, and well,
so you're fucked. And so if you're looking to plug that into a speaker dock, you're fucked.
So here's the thing. My understanding is that they shared the specs for the Lightning connector, the 8-pin Lightning connector, with a relatively small number of very close partners.
Right.
Everyone else found out about it on the same day we all did when they announced the iPhone 5.
Right.
So, you know, you figure it takes 6 months to bring a product like that to market. And there's all sorts of new rules about it's not just a straight pin for pin switch.
Right.
Like there have to be new boards designed, new DAX design. Right. They have to license all the stuff. They have to get it approved. It could be after Christmas before we start seeing some of that stuff. My hunch is we'll see a handful of things at Christmas.
Because even you're saying these preferred partners, we
had late notice.
Right.
That's my hunch.
Because we haven't seen, there's no third party Lightning dock.
Nothing.
On the market yet.
There's nothing that uses the Lightning connector that's not made by Apple,
right?
As far as I know right now.
Right. So all those guys have got to be scrambled.
Right. Even the guys like Mophie, who traditionally just make a case that has a plug on the bottom.
Yeah.
None of those have started shipping.
Yeah. So power cases like the Juice Pack, that stuff has got to. They went from, I guess, imagining it would be a very easy transition to just redesigning the size of the case. And they're like, oh shit, we have to do this thing from scratch.
And it all has to be licensed and Apple's approving everything. I wonder if...
But it's in Apple's interest to have a healthy third-party ecosystem, right?
I don't know.
Different devices.
I mean, do you think so? If they make the experience bad for people, is that a good thing for Apple, or not so much?
No, but assuming that they can be good, then having all those devices just increases the value and the functionality of the device Apple makes.
Maybe. I'm going to go ahead and tell you something right now. I feel like that Mophie Juice Pack I bought and those Goal Zero big USB batteries, watching the people in Sandy without power... Like having the ability to charge up a phone or an e-reader or something like that seems like it would be incredibly
useful. Well, I was going to say that big handheld battery thing that you have would definitely be in any 72-hour bag.
I bought because we have one for the office, but I bought one for home.
And I'm usually quite militant about not having a case for my phone, but when they do eventually get around to a iPhone 5 Mophie pack, I will probably get one.
Just buy the external brick.
No, I like having it all in one.
Okay.
You think you really need? I mean, for emergencies, or are you actually gonna
for shows and when I'm traveling, like when I know I'm gonna use it a lot and I'm constantly kind of got one eye on the battery indicator. It's just nice to not have to worry about it.
Hmm. There you go. Anything else we've been testing, Norm? We drank a lot of Black Blood out of the Earth during October.
You know, I didn't touch any of that stuff.
Last year it was drinking it straight. This year, since we have a lot extra left over, because we actually didn't drink that much on the show and felt pretty good. We have a lot left over, and I've been mixing it with hot water, and it's great with equal parts.
I've been doing hot water and iced and hot, actually.
Yeah, because Patrick Norton brought in something that was quite similar, and he gave me a sip of his, and it wasn't for me. I get it. It's not for me.
Yeah. You know, we did test some Lego stuff this weekend. We tested those Kusu.
The Minecraft Lego sets?
Yeah.
How
did you find those sets?
I thought it was an awesome set.
You weren't really testing them under optimal conditions, though.
If you
look at the two sets, let's get clear
right
now. Both of those sets, after they were built, were the most sloppily built Lego sets.
They were, I mean, you had
especially
to
with the fiddly pieces.
You had to redo yours.
Like squares were not aligned anywhere.
No, that's the thing is, if you look at all those one by one blocks on the top, they're all like kettywomp.
Also, I know the ruling's been made, and this is after the fact, but we did find some discrepancies even after the final judgment was made.
I mean, yes, look, but yours was definitely more wrong than mine was.
It's after, not after the final final.
It's cool that there is Minecraft Lego. It's really cool, but like, looking at the finished model, it really just does look like something you would slap together with a bucket of bricks without any design in mind. Just, oh, here's a thing that
you have to open up the inside and look at it, because the tops come off. The land comes off and you can see what's inside in the caves.
You have to really appreciate Minecraft.
And that's the thing. I think because I'm not really a Minecraft player, I'm not appreciating
that might be
the cleverness
it is. It is quite clever if you're into Minecraft.
Yeah.
So that'll do it for what we're testing. Let's take one email and call it a show.
Emails?
Well, but we do the other one.
Emails.
You know, we don't do emails, we do.
Emails?
No.
Questions.
Boom.
If you have a question for This Is Only Test, the email address is podcast@tested.com. Keep it under 45 seconds and make sure you sound like you are not recording it from a train. We only got one question in this week. So send more questions if you want us to keep doing questions on the show. Here is the question.
Hey there, Tested Crew. This is Mike from Philadelphia. I had a question about iTunes Match. I'm thinking about getting a new iPad mini, and I know that they're still coming in 16, 32, and 64 gig sizes. I got a huge music collection, about 17,000 songs. A lot of that stuff was stuff that I purchased from Amazon's store just because I wasn't a big fan of iTunes DRM back in the day, as well as ripped CDs and whatnot. So is that going to be a good match for me if I end up going with a 16 gig iPad along with the iPhone that I own to get iTunes Match in the cloud for my situation? Another question is would you rather have Apple release a new piece of hardware that you just bought every 6 months, or would you rather have Disney release a brand new Star Wars film every 2 years? Thanks. Always be testing.
I don't think people understand the concept of the would you rather.
Yeah.
Because the whole point, the only reason the would you rather works is if it's either two things you'd really, really want.
Which is tough.
And you have to choose between the one you like most.
Yeah.
Like cake or pie, because I love both cake and pie. It's very hard for me to choice.
Let's just have that conversation instead.
Well, hold on, there's another way you can do it.
The answer is clearly cake.
I'm going to give you a meta would you rather. Would you rather answer a would you rather between two things you really love, or between two things that are really terrible, and you have to pick the one.
I always prefer the ones about happy things.
No, terrible.
Like, look, it's this. Would you rather?
We have listened to your would you rather and judged it unworthy, caller.
If you're saying to me, would you rather have a conversation about would you rather eat cake or pie, or would you rather burn to death or drown? Yes,
I would rather drown.
No, the point I'm making is I would rather have the cake conversation.
No, I think the listeners would rather have the conversation about
drowning. I know that if we're in in service of our audience,
would
much rather think about us burning to death or drowning.
Yeah.
I would rather talk about eating cake or eating pie.
So let's
cake or pie?
Cake.
I think the meta conversation was much more interesting.
I would say this to you. If it was a real, if you were actually being put to death.
Yeah.
And
like this is your last meal?
And you had to choose between burning to death or drowning.
Drowning.
I guarantee that whichever one you picked, you'd wind up wishing you'd picked the other one. Because both of them are so horrible that you would wish you'd gone the other way.
So if you're being put to death for drowning, do you like hold your breath for as long as possible? Or do you just suck in the water?
I imagine they would just like weigh you down with something and throw you in a.
I'm saying as you're sinking to the bottom
of
the river.
What's your
strategy for death?
I think you want to get it over with as quickly as possible.
So what's the most efficient way to do that?
You suck in, just suck
swallow
in,
as swallow much water as,
suck
you can.
As much, yeah.
And let it hit
See,
brain.
I didn't want to have this conversation.
That's terrifying.
I wanted to talk about delicious cake versus delicious pie.
Cake, while technically impressive and can be structurally fantastic and can actually have a lovely taste and texture, I find the dichotomy between a soft, sweet, delicious filling and a crispy, crunchy crust is wonderful.
It's all about texture. And as long as we're casting the net wide enough to say that pie encompasses things like chocolate cream pie and custard pie,
absolutely,
banana cream pie, yes, pie wins every time.
Yeah.
No.
Yes.
I prefer cake.
Because like a chocolate cream pie is like a cake in a pie. Oh, so it's like it's they thought of everything.
Yeah. You know what nobody's made yet is a molten lava, chocolate lava cake pie. Because you should be able to put that in a pie shell, theoretically.
Like, I love birthday cake. But after a few
pieces.
Yellow
cake?
Just like white cake.
Fluffier.
Like the white fluffy cake?
But after a few pieces of cake, I'm like, I'm over it.
Nope.
And you know what? I can eat a whole pie.
I'm going to tell you, frosting is overrated.
I don't need totally frosting. Overrated.
Because frosting is fucking gross.
Yeah. Don't need fondant, don't need frosting. Just want
the, I agree.
The thing that's great about pie is you have a little, like, if you do the crust right, it's a little salt sweet and a little salty, and then you have something that's not too sweet in the filling, like apples or pumpkin or whatever.
You cannot get the salty with the cake.
Yeah.
Cake is
and
just
also, the best part about pie, the other thing that you're not even thinking about is you can heat it up. Hot cherry pie with ice cream.
Yep.
You get the hot pie and the cold ice cream. Because a la mode.
It's part of the whole equation.
But a hot piece of pie with cold ice cream all together is fantastic.
I'm glad that once and for all time, even Norm agrees, and he's a cake lover, we've settled one of the great debates of the internet. Cake or pie?
No.
I think, well, by two to one vote.
I think it is.
The debate continues.
By 2-1 vote.
I think that this is, nobody can talk about this anymore.
No more cake for the office.
No, it's
conversation
been settled.
Done. Yeah.
It's been settled.
This is the final word on the matter. Sweet, salty, different textures, variety of fillings.
Greater variety.
Yeah. There was a real tech question in there, briefly.
It was about iTunes Match on an iPad.
Yeah,
Mini.
I think iTunes Match is pretty good.
It's pretty good. It would be easy for him to take all his Amazon music and just put it all in Apple's cloud.
That's
right?
What I did. In fairness, I did it right around the time the beta was over, right when it was public for the first time. So they may have fixed the problems. De-explicited
music,
a fair amount of my music.
I was not thrilled about that.
Right, when we were playing Power and it didn't have the naughty bits, really detracts from the song.
If you listen to a lot of rap music or music that has a lot of curse
Morrissey.
Words in it, you're going to find
Van Halen.
Yeah, that's not cool.
But the ability over cellular or Wi-Fi to just download whatever track, single tracks, entire albums at one click.
So for the, I'm actually thinking for the Mini, if and when I buy a Mini tomorrow, I'll probably just get the 16 gig.
So
I'm not going to put a lot on it, and any stuff and any content, I'll probably just stream it.
I haven't put any content on my phone or iPad, like any music content on my phone or iPad.
Yeah.
In like since iOS 5 came out.
Yeah. Can you within iTunes and music on your iOS device delete stuff?
Yes, you have to swipe and delete. It's a little bit unwieldy. Like the tools to manage that process are I don't want to say bad, but they're fucking terrible.
Bad.
They're really fucking awful.
And they're bad.
Yeah. I mean, it's pretty shit.
But yeah, to answer the guy's question, yes, I think a 16 gig would be fine. But just bear in mind, you're going to be burning data, you know?
Well, and when you compare that to the cost of like a subscription service like Spotify or RDO, if you're buying music, then it's a better investment. If you think you're going to spend less by just paying $10 a month for the rest of your life to get the music you want, then do the sub service. They're right. Compelling too.
Right.
So that'll do it for questions. podcast@tested.com. We're out of questions. This was the last one in the thing that we could use. So if you've sent something in that we haven't aired, maybe resend it or alternately ask us some new questions. And remember, would you rathers between two things that are awesome or two things that are terrible? Not between one thing that's kind of okay and another thing that's kind of okay.
I think
like I got where he was going.
He was going for two things that were possibly
pretty good.
Awesome. I would actually go for the two Star Wars movies.
Also, it's kind of difficult to make a hypothetical about when both things actually happen anyway. Like, we don't have to make that choice.
Yeah.
Disney's going to release these Star Wars movies. Apple's going to keep releasing new products. So we don't really have
to make the thing
choice.
Is, it's ambiguous because either of those could be terrible. Like, what if the Star Wars movies are all really bad and it's like there's a Jar Jar Binks trilogy?
Or what if
the
Apple products are all really iterative?
Right.
Oh, wait. They're both. Both is the case.
Or what if the Apple products are really expensive? I don't have any money to buy stuff. That would be bad.
Yeah. So it doesn't have the same kind of nuance as cake versus pie.
Like, would you rather be? we're looking for real depth here. Next week, bacon versus ham.
Probably the most successful would you rather we've ever had is that one we had at Tested Live 2 packs ago, where the guy said, "Would you rather fight?" Was it like a gaggle of angry ducks?
That's the
gaggle of duck-sized horses.
That's the
or
Reddit
like one
question.
One horse-sized duck.
That was
good.
The Reddit AMA question.
Well, you know this because you read the Adam and Jamie ones.
I knew that before because I've read a shitload of AMAs.
I don't go on Reddit, so I don't know. I remember thinking that was a great question.
Yeah, Jamie's the only person ever who took the duck-sized horse.
And of course, whatever led us to Bag of Raccoons was pretty good as well.
Yeah. I don't think that was even a would you rather, was it?
I don't know how we got there, but it was good.
Yeah. So anyway, this has only a test. We do it every Thursday. There's still three more Oktoberfest to post at the time we're recording.
Do you want
to
remind people also that it's not too late to donate?
It is not too late to donate to Oktoberfest. If you love kids and want to ease their suffering in times of woe, then you should support Child's Play, whether it's through Oktoberfest or one of the other many perfectly worthwhile but less awesome charities.
So how would they do that?
Well, they would go to oktoberfest.chipin.com or tested.com/donate is the other
easier way.
The chip-in widget on that page says $404 for me no matter what I do. I think it shows whatever
you've got a 404 error.
Something like that.
But it's in fact over $30,000.
We crossed $30,000 this morning. We've gotten payment for all of the stuff, like the pistol that you hold in your hands right now.
Yeah, so the Mass Effect Special Edition tested... Powered-in pistol.
Yeah, the cardifacts.
That we can only show pictures of on October because it's actually here now, and it's a real thing. Cool. And this went for $1,500.
$1,500.
Worth every
one of a kind item.
Yeah, totally unique.
So we have a couple of other things like that. All that stuff's going out.
We have some signed copies of Walking Dead. We've got the laptop Ultrabook hybrid thing that Darren brought in. We did good this year.
I feel like, there were a lot of people, we didn't raise quite as much money as we did last year, which I know a lot of people were talking about.
But you have to remember, last year was more about us being, we were still kind of part of Giant Bomb and that. It was all, Whiskey Media. It was all just a bigger thing.
Well, and also last year, Extra Life this year, which was the week before us, raised a ton more money on the Giant Bomb community
and
side.
I don't even look at it this way. Great. If someone says, they didn't raise as much as last year, first of all, fuck you. Second of all,
I wouldn't have probably put it that way.
I certainly would and will.
Yes.
And second of all, 30 grand for sick children is nothing to be sneezed at.
I mean, that's the thing is I look at it and I'm like, what else would I have done with those 24 hours? Not raised 30 grand for sick kids.
Right. Absolutely.
So like Gary said, it's not too late. If you want to chip in, you can go to tested.com/donate. Every bit helps. And if you have a stupid request that you'd like to see us do and a whole shitload of money, we can probably make that happen. So... I'm not going to kill anybody or do anything illegal or even that it's unsavory. But, pitch your ideas. Tips@tested.com. We'll see what we can do. Other things, we didn't talk about this yet, but we posted the first high-speed camera video.
Oh, that video of you slapping each other has been really popular.
It's real dumb.
Yeah.
We can do dumber.
Yeah.
It's coming up on Monday.
Yeah.
We'll do Mondays, assuming production moves forward. Mondays will be high speed days for the next few weeks, and we have
some bunch popular content.
We have some next week is liquid nitrogen, so you can imagine we got three different sizes of sledgehammer. I'm not going to say anything else.
All right, I'm excited about that.
If you want to see Norm and I not high five in really spectacular fashion, or throw ninja throwing stars through water balloons, or what else do we do? Smash rocks with hammers.
Just gotta watch the video.
Yeah, just watch the video. It's real dumb. Norm laid a slap on me. It's hard to do.
It was a good slap. That actually did look like he made pretty good contact. I need to see it at full speed.
You actually don't need to slap very hard
to get the jowls jiggle.
Yeah.
I feel like you slapped me a lot harder than I slapped you.
No.
I'm just saying.
No.
If you're going to give someone a free shot,
there's a lot of behind the scenes footage.
You got to assume they're going to take it.
Well, the thing is.
No, we had this conversation on Oktoberfest.
Yeah.
That you need the killer instinct doesn't naturally come. When it comes down to the actual moment of slap, you hold back a little bit. You don't want to kill the guy.
You don't want to hurt somebody.
You're not going to kill someone by slapping them.
No, I know. I'm just saying. But the point is,
you could slap them silly.
Like you don't have context.
What does that even mean?
This is a Seinfeld episode now. Congratulations. You don't have the context for the hit. Like we're so far removed from punching people in the face that we don't know what the appropriate amount of punch is anymore.
That's right.
And you know what? The slap, the follow through actually helps lessen the pain. It's like the roll.
No, that's bullshit. Your finger went up my nose practically. It was really uncomfortable.
We have slow motion. It did not. You're also a big
way
baby.
Close.
You're a big baby.
Oh, I'm the big baby.
Yes.
You should have seen the one that we didn't use.
I did.
That'll do it for us this week. We'll see you guys next week. No fake outtakes this week. We did 24 fucking hours of podcast earlier this week. You're lucky we're even alive now.
Seems like nothing. This app happened last year too.
It seems like it happened in another lifetime.
After Oktoberfest last year,
this normal podcast today.
A normal podcast, 2 hours just flew by.
We've been going way longer than 2 hours. We're at 2 hours and 20 minutes. I mean, that's the thing.
Our usual length.
That's what she said.
But it went by much quicker because 24 hours.
Yeah,
we can do 2 hours standing on our head now.
It's good. Okay. Hold on, I'm going to play, I lied, we are going to do fake outtakes for a minute. I'm going to play the outro song, which is from KJN today. Here you go. And then we're going to talk for just a moment.
Hi there, I didn't see you. tested.
That was pretty stupid.
I was real stupid.
Let's go stupider.
Okay.
Tested.
Was this year easier or more difficult?
Easier.
I thought so.
I thought more difficult.
Norm, you were much... Okay, easier. I gave you a bunch of shit about pushing for the 6 p.m. to 6 p.m. You are absolutely right, because the 6 a.m. window, like the coming into 6 a.m. when the sun's getting ready to come up, was much, much easier much this easier. Go-round. Even though we'd been awake longer and all that.
And the final four hours.
If we easier. Do this again, I'm going to be pushing strong to go back to the noon-to-noon model, not 6 p.m.
I would say if we're going to do that, we should do 9 to 9.
Well, that, either way.
You lose the second day.
I don't care about that.
It was hard to get people booked for Saturday. I will say that.
Maybe so. I'm just saying I struggled more to make it all the way. I mean, I clearly
you
was
flagged hard.
I was able to do it, but I suffered more in those early hours.
Norm perked up. Norm, you had some a little lull early in the morning, and that's then
mostly the boredom from the content.
Yeah, that's true. It was not very
And the
good.
Problem is, when having people come in here, like Adam or whatever, or fucking Ryan, who's just rolled out of bed, going, fresh as a daisy, oh, hello, everyone. I'm like, fuck you.
Yeah,
I've been up
yeah.
all night.
You got kind of, it got kind of dark there for a little bit so I listened to some of those podcasts. One thing I will note is you can definitely tell our relative caffeine level is very high. Like, we yeah. were talking really fast by the time Adam showed up.
What do you think the highlights were?
Well, the bit in the Adam segment when you just said, I'm not allowed to take Ambien anymore. And then everybody just kind of walked on.
Yeah.
And then we all did a hard break.
It's kind of circled back.
And we're like, wait, something funny just happened. Jeff Green's Skull Bong, which is coming up.
Jeff Green's Skull Bong was great. I loved talking about Jeff Gerstmann's heist.
The raid.
The raid. The raid.
I want to go on the raid.
I hope he does it.
I think he's going to do
Scanlon's,
it.
Drew Scanlon's two stories, North Korea
oh,
and
fascinating stories about North Korea
actually,
and the TriCaster lady.
Getting Drew and Patrick here at the same time was perfect.
Yeah.
Because Drew is a manly man. Patrick is a manly man.
Yeah. It was very testosterone heavy. I mean, could smell it. The musk was rising.
We're good. That's enough.
It's almost
about
like a urologist's office.
Idle thumbs were very
those guys are great. I feel bad because we didn't talk about Remo's game at all, but I don't think they're talking about his
Adam,
game right now.
Adam, who, you
Who's
obviously
Adam?
Know, Adam Savage.
Oh, yeah.
The guy with pictures behind
the
us.
The guy you work for.
Oh, yeah, he's right there.
Seemed to, it was my first time meeting him, so I was a little bit, because I didn't want to, like,
that was awkward, huh?
I didn't want to be full on Gary and, like, get you guys into trouble. Like, who the fuck is this guy?
Yeah, I appreciate that.
So I just kind of like kept it very dialed back. But I, you know, I could talk to him all day. I mean, he's fucking fascinating.
He's gregarious.
He strikes you as like just a super interesting guy.
Yeah.
Right? Very smart, very interesting, very knowledgeable on a wide range of subjects.
He left here and went and made Patton Oswalt's Halloween costume.
Yeah, which looks great. I saw the pictures. It looks great.
Yeah.
So yeah, that was great. Cool. So yeah, lots of good stuff. Jeff Green, as you say, had some fascinating subjects. Sticking pencils in his face.
Alexis came in and Vinny's always good.
Vinny had a terrific Mad Lib.
Yeah.
And
a nice conversation all around.
Yeah, just interesting stuff all around.
I hope his child never listens to that podcast.
Alexis is very low energy, but very interesting if you listen to
him. Well, he also comes in at like midnight. He came in at midnight, so he's a little pooped.
But talking about his Halo marathon was fascinating.
Yep. Yeah.
And yeah, you're right. I mean,
the late afternoon guest, Jason Cross, filled in as our
did you go home and watch it?
No, God, no.
He had other shit going on.
How was Patrick?
Patrick was great.
Your closer.
Yeah, Patrick. Well, so Jason stayed on after you left, and he filled the Gary seat for us.
And I was bummed because I really wanted to talk to Patrick about horror, because that's his other
big interest.
Because it was Halloween, I really wanted to talk to him about his love of horror, and I didn't get to do that.
When we talked about his, like,
you have to watch the show.
31 days of horror movies.
Yeah.
Which is more of a life goal rather than an actual actionable list.
Yeah.
Let's see. He hugged the Lost window. We didn't tell people this during the show because I didn't want to blow the surprise for Patrick. But this thing right here behind us is a window from the set of Lost.
Oh, okay. From the
like
from
they
Oceanic?
Cut it out of the plane out of Oceanic whatever. I didn't watch that show either. 8:15. Yeah.
Ah.
That's it. It's weathered and stuff. We'll do a set tour soon. We'll do a whole office tour because we're about done.
You got some good stuff here. Yeah, I need to go anyway. So this has been good.
Yeah, we'll see you guys next week.
Yep.
Another episode.